winters in the Great Lakes are rugged, yet some places withstand the harshness of Mother Nature and for much of the year stand guard, ready to entertain when the sun returns. Like the Milwaukee Mile, whose stock car history began in 1956 and first blossomed in the 60s when racing's most famous names, Jones, Boyd, and Ward, won here. That tradition would be passed on to a then upstart organization that was building its own history at places like here, Indianapolis Raceway Park, Winchester, and Salem. Finally, in 84, Mother Nature took another turn, and these two, ASA and Milwaukee, teamed up. The glorious history of stock cars in Badgerland lived on. 1 week ago, ASA's most recent chapter was written by its winningest driver of all time, cashing in on the season's longest trip, Alberta, Canada. Today, he and 37 others will again waken the napping sentry of the North, the Milwaukee Mile. Indianapolis cars, Silver Crown dirt cars, and stock cars, all a part of Milwaukee's past. And today, the American Speed Association stock cars. Now, the history of the Milwaukee Mile spans most of this decade. This is the 23rd time that the ASA cars have been here, and there have been 11 different winners. The biggest names in the history of ASA racing have won here. The last televised race on TNN of ASA, one of the most spectacular in recent history on television. My cohort for today's broadcast, Rob Albright.
Larry, it's been a literal 4,000-mile odyssey for the majority of the starters in today's field. After Nashville, last weekend, Calgary, Alberta, Canada, all the way from the shadows of the Canadian Rockies, and a great weekend for Bob Seneca winning the first time this season.
Rob, this is the second time this year the ASAers have had a chance to write history at the Milwaukee Mile. What do you think about this one?
I don't know, Larry. We've got some real veterans on that front row, but with the qualifying surprises from yesterday, I think we're going to see a new first-time winner in Victory Lane.
Well, joining us on this broadcast is Ralph Shaheen, and he is standing by with one of those surprises that Rob alluded to. Now, this may not be surprising to you, but take a listen.
To find Mike Eddy at the front of the field at the end of an AC-Delco Challenge Series event is nothing unusual. But to find him there at the start of the race, that's something we don't get to see too often. Mike Eddy, you're starting on the pole here today. What made the difference in yesterday's qualifying runs for you?
Well, I qualified way back in the pack today, and that made the difference. I knew the mark I had to beat, so I worked real hard on the attempt to qualify to set on the pole.
We've had an IndyCar race here since then. Has this racetrack changed at all? Is it going to change your strategy since you won here the last time we were here earlier this year?
Well, the kart race didn't really change the track because there's been a lot of rain since then. It's just that it's hotter now than it was in the spring, so that changes the track a little bit.
Well, starting from the pole doesn't mean you're necessarily going to win. Mike's got to deal with his normal AC-Delco Challenge Series competitors, and then another guy starting right alongside of him, a native of the state of Wisconsin and a true, wily old veteran himself, Dick Trickle.
Well, Ralph, that other guy, Dick Trickle, has won five times here in ASA competition, the most ever by anyone in this division. Bob Seneca has won three times. Mike Eddy has won twice, as has Scott Hansen. And all four of those drivers are in today's field. Now, Ralph is moving down to the head of the field, where he is going to be talking to a host of people, including Tim Sauer, the vice president for automotive for Blain's Farm and Fleet, sponsors of today's race, and Gil Cashin, the national sales manager for AC-Delco. Ralph?
Thank you, Larry. Gil, we'd like to welcome you to the Nashville Network and to the famous Milwaukee Mile.
Thanks, Ralph. I'd like to say to all the fans here, we have a beautiful day, and on behalf of all of AC-Delco, retailers and wholesalers, let's have a great race today. And I'd also like to say to all my friends and fans down in NASCAR country, if you thought that Nashville, when Darrell Waltrip won the race, was a thriller, stay tuned. This is Let It All Hang Out Racing, ASA, and we're going to have a thriller here today. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Tim Sauer, Blain's Farm and Fleet, who's going to get this show on the road.
Thank you, Gil. Gentlemen, let's go racing.
All right.
38 American Speed Association stock cars roar to life in the pit area of the legendary, historic Milwaukee Mile. Mike Eddy on the right, on the pole, and on the left, Dick Trickle. Leading the field on today's parade lap, a special treat. We're happy to present for the first time on live television the new 1992 GM models, the Cadillac Elante, Pontiac Firebird, and Chevrolet Cavalier, the best from Detroit from 1992. This 200-lapper at the Milwaukee Mile is just moments away from firing off. We'll be here live, and you're watching on the Nashville Network. The 1991 AC-Delco Challenge Series on TNN is brought to you by Coors Light, the one that won't slow you down. The Silver Bullet is the right beer now. And by Goodyear, the unanimous choice of every race team in the AC-Delco Challenge Series. And by Just For Men, from the leader in men's hair coloring, blends away gray in 5 minutes. And by Skin Bracer Aftershave by Minute. There's no better way to face the day. And by Delco Voyager, reliable, durable for the long day. 200 laps on a one-mile racetrack equate to 200 miles. How about the weather here in Milwaukee this weekend? Well, we hit the jackpot. 85 very clear degrees, humidity 50%, very, very comfortable for the Great Lakes region. The wind is negligible. It says mostly sunny, but there are very few clouds in the sky.
Not only is the weather perfect, but the racetrack is a perfect oval. 1 mile in length each straightaway, exactly 1/4 mile each turn, 1/4 mile, and it seats more than 35,000 spectators.
And as we mentioned, this racetrack has a glorious motor racing past. It is one of the first facilities across the country that opened its doors up to motor racing activities. They ran horses here about 100 years ago.
Averaging just one pole per year in his 18 ASA seasons, the Nationwide Auto Parts Pontiac Carnivore 88 of Mike Eddy, and a five-time winner at the Milwaukee Mile, the Trickle Motorsports Chevy of Dick Trickle.
Side by side in row number two on the inside, Jeff Neal and the Xerox Ruggles Victor Buick, and Scott Hansen, a winner here in the Delta Faucet Baker Enterprises of Wisconsin car.
Starting fifth and winless since 1979 in ASA, and car number 36 from Lake Villa, Illinois, the Rapco prototype Chevy of Joe Scheer, and alongside last year's rookie of the year, car number 21, Johnny Benson Jr. in the Valvoline Oil Berger Chevy.
Seventh and eighth start, Kent Stauffer, Elyria, Ohio, the Kinetic Engines Ford, and Glenn Allen, the teenager from Cincinnati.
In the fifth row from Madison, Wisconsin, the all-car automotive Chevy, car number 93 of John Ziegler, and defending series champion, the Lane Automotive Chevrolet, car number 84, Bob Seneker.
Coming off of his best career finish, Jay Sauter from nearby Nacita, Wisconsin, is on the inside of the sixth row, and Harold Fair, the veteran, twice runner-up in points, on the outside.
In the seventh row, the popular Ted Musgrave in car number 98, the Wisconsin Aviation Chevrolet, and Steve Burgess from Eau Claire, Wisconsin, in the Gellin Enterprises Chevrolet, car number 12.
On the inside of the next row, one of the top qualifying surprises, Kenny Adams from Willowick, Ohio, and Tim Fedewa from Lansing, Michigan, in the DNR Racing Enterprises Chevy.
Sporting Delco Voyager battery colors on his Chevrolet this weekend, from Fenton, Missouri, Ken Schrader, and Dave Jackson in the Red Bank Trout Lycan Chevy from Cincinnati, almost won at Calgary.
In the A1 Auto Service, Robesto Chevrolet, Gary St. Amant from Columbus, Ohio, and Tony Raines, watch him, he may move up in the E&L Brokerage Olds. And here is the rest of the starting grid in the 11th row. That's 21st and 22nd starting positions. Bruce Vanderland from Michigan and Bob Menner, one of the Wisconsin drivers who has entered. In the 12th row, Dick Beinlich and Tom Harrington, the former professional football player. In row number 13, side by side, are cars number 44 and 51, driven by John Olson and Dennis Vogel. In the 14th row, Scott Kaiser. And coming up from the south, Lee Farthing, an interesting story we'll get into a little later. In row number 15, from Dayton, Ohio, Dean South, and then Terry Baldry, a regular in 1991. Tim Steele, he has the potential to move up. One of the top runners, starting way back in the 16th row, and Dennis Lampman having his personal best season in ASA. In row number 17, John Wilson and Tom Jones. The 18th row, Dave Stomm and Steve Barnes. And in the 19th and final row, that's the 37th and 38th start positions, car number 57, Dennis Robertson, and car number 47, Butch Mirandorf.
Interesting composition of the field. 23 Chevys, 6 Pontiacs, 4 Buicks, 3 Oldsmobiles, and 2 Fords. And now we're riding with last year's Rookie of the Year, Johnny Benson Jr. This is the view that he'll get, Larry, at the start.
Johnny Benson led the points for the first 4 or 5 races of this season. He has slipped behind a little bit right now, but you'll be actually getting the same view, as Rob mentioned, that he gets.
Well, the driver who many expected to capture the pole here this weekend, disappointed with his fourth place qualifying start here this afternoon, Scott Hansen. He is tough on this racetrack.
Scott Hansen has two career wins on this racetrack. He has won one of the last three races, meaning in the 1990 or 91 season. And he definitely will be a man to be reckoned with. He may have been disappointed, but third place ain't bad.
If he ever wanted to win a race, it's today. New sponsorship colors from Delta Faucets. Those people are tuned in, and he's going to be carrying the camera, hopefully, to make them proud this afternoon.
You see those 1992 GM products. Yes, I said that right. 1992, that's like next season, you know, 6 months away, are leading the field around as they now enter corner number three. We'll have apparently at least one more parade lap before we get into the pace lap, that final lap, as the field then is turned over to the hands of the front row.
Bob Seneker didn't qualify for particularly well for this afternoon's race, but he comes in with some tremendous confidence, having won at Calgary, the most grueling of all the races on the ASA schedule. What made it particularly rewarding for Bob, it is the richest race on the schedule.
Seneker has moved into the points lead, and that's got to be an ominous sign for the rest of the competitors, because here's a guy who's known for being so good in the second half of the season. We're almost there, but not quite.
Well, it had to create some real mixed emotions for car owner Leroy Troop, because it was the team car to the Seneker machine that Bob displaced at the top of the heap, and that's, of course, the Johnny Benson car.
There you see the field moving by the start-finish line for the last time today in parade soldier formation. 38 cars strong. It's a beautiful sight. You see the green of Glenn Allen. You see the bright blue and yellow of the number 12 of Steve Burgess. And there is the white and baby blue of car number 25, Tony Raines. Now we go back and look at Tony, because Tony begins this race in the 20th position, the outside of the 10th row. But here's a man who's never won, but Rob, I think he has shown the potential to win a race this year.
Tony does not belong back there. He ran very well at Calgary, was involved in a couple of on-track incidents. His first ever career ASA win came right here on the Milwaukee Mile in the then junior Grand Mark Series a couple of seasons ago.
And as Rob points out, that was not the national series that you're watching today. All right, the field is now coming around corners three and four. Mike Eddy and Dick Trickle, you could not have two more qualified veterans to lead a field around. This should be a near picture perfect start. Here comes Eddy in black, the Nationwide colors, at the white car on the outside. That's Dick Trickle. We have a green flag.
Field absolutely in perfect formation as they went down into turn number one. That's the time that you're most concerned about the start in our qualifying race yesterday, Larry. Major problems at the start of that event.
Eddy had a great corner number one and two. He was right down in the bottom of the lane, but Dick Trickle on the outside was able to keep the engine revving just a little higher. He kept pace. Top speeds here are about 140 miles an hour, and that's just about what they're ascending to when you pick up that shot right at ground level. It's a great one. Eddy leads lap number one.
Scott Hansen challenging Dick Trickle for the second spot. Appears to have the advantage. Look at him run right down on the white line in turn number three. Trickle fights back on the high side.
Dick Trickle electing to stay in the second lane around this one-mile oval. He has lost a little bit of ground to race leader Mike Eddy. Now it's a lot of ground, and he's in jeopardy of losing second position to Scott Hansen, who runs right down there on the rail.
Mike Eddy pulling out to a significant advantage this time, heading down the back straightaway. Johnny Benson Jr., who has a car here that has not been on the racetrack since it competed in the first race of the year on the third mile at Columbus, not happy. We've got problems already.
The yellow flag is coming out. You see there in corner number one, the brightly painted car number 32 of Steve Barnes. That's the Mackinac, Illinois driver. It's kind of an interesting story. He sells his sponsor's product, Microbrush, and that's what finances this car. Steve, trying to roll off of the wall. Maybe he has designs of getting back into this race.
Well, a lot of drivers will go to the company that they work for as a full-time job and say, hey, put your name on my race car since I work for you. Steve did it the other way around. Coming from what is referred to as the enduro cars, where they just put a whole bunch of street stockers on a little tiny racetrack and run for 3 hours, this was a real step up for Barnes.
Here is the spin as it took place. You see Barnes going sideways. Yeah, he backs on the wall pretty hard. The number 30 sitting near that red car is Lee Farthing from Myrtle Beach, South Carolina. Dean Combs, now, a lot of our friends in the South will recognize that name as one of the Darlington Dash Stars of about 5 years ago, is the mechanic on that car. And Lee was very anxious to run today, and this has got to be a big disappointment for him. We'll be back as soon as this yellow flag ends. You're looking at the white and red trim, number 21 of Johnny Benson, who for five races. And Rob, look what's hanging there.
Oh, no.
2 nights ago. Oh. Weren't you looking for those?
I have been set up big time. I locked those in the trunk of the rental car in the first turn here at the Milwaukee Mile. You and Benson are in cahoots. You're going to pay for this.
You were late for the baseball game made everybody, including Ralph Shaheen, late. You guys missed a terrific first inning. Ralph, you got a bone to pick with this guy.
Hey, Rob.
Hey.
Gotcha.
You're dead, dude.
The 32 car of Steve Barnes is in the pits, and Ralph, we're going to put you back to work. Take him, my man.
Well, Steve Barnes, as you said, Larry, is in here to the pits. You can see the crew going to work. The entire rear section of this Buick machine is totally pushed in. The fiberglass body panel's just hanging off the car. As the crew now will go to work on the left side, the right side has some damage as well. They're going to work on this side. You can see the sledgehammers being brought in there. Crowbars were used. They're doing everything they can to get the body parts away from the car. Looks like they got some frame problems as well. They're going to try and get it all bent up, locked up, and we'll go back to racing with Steve Barnes as soon as they can.
Mike Eddy is picking up the pace, Ralph. Mike Eddy is ready to go racing. I think ASA has the green flag flies, moving to the outside of Scott Hansen. Can Hansen out-drag Mike Eddy going into corner number one?
That's Dick Trickle on the outside, and car number 99 appeared to be falling back just before the caution was displayed. Hansen is there, dropping way down on the low side of the racetrack. He's there to challenge. What a battle for that lead, Larry.
Absolutely, Rob. You are right. Two white-painted cars, and Dick Trickle made a tremendous jump. Jumped to the outside of both Hansen and Eddie. Trickle's been running there all race long. You got to figure he knows this track better than anybody else. He must know what he's doing.
He's got more laps on this racetrack than any driver in the field. This machine is in actuality 4 years old. The last time he brought it here, it had a Camaro body. This time he brings it back with alumina. I talked to him yesterday, and surprisingly, I felt that the Camaro might be a bit more aerodynamic. Trickle says the alumina is more stable.
Just updating you on the Steve Barnes situation, that the aqua yellow pink number 32 that you saw in the pits a few moments ago, the engine has been shut down, but the crew continues to work. Out on the track, lots of work going on.
The first time we saw that third place car number 53 of Scott Hansen, you can see it now coming into the screen, just waiting to determine which line to take, depending on who gets the lead. Was several seasons ago. He was not at that time a regular with the ASA series. He brought one of the first V6s ever to the Milwaukee Mile, when most drivers thought you had to run a V8 to be competitive on this fast track.
Riding with third running Scott Hansen, Green Bay, Wisconsin, trying to pick a lane. Do I follow Trickle? Do I follow Eddie? Mike Eddy has led from the drop of the green flag, but it's been a very precarious lead. You see him sliding out of corner number four, accelerating up to 130, 140 miles per hour before just brush braking, entering corner number one.
You can see all three of those leaders handling extremely well. Steve Burgess has got a problem in car number 12, the Justice Brothers Gilland Enterprises machine. Steve competed for Rookie of the Year last season, just running a handful of races in 1991. That's sometimes what happens, Larry. You try to come and just run a few times, it's awfully difficult to compete with these guys who race week in and week out.
Some of the masters of the Milwaukee Mile portrait, Mike Eddy, Dick Trickle, and Scott Hansen, whom again you're riding with, continue to dominate this race. You can see Hansen looks like he's feeling a little faster than Dick Trickle, but Dick knows this track so well, he's very, very difficult to pass.
Well, Scott's fellow drivers have tremendous respect for him. He seems to keep a level head in all circumstances. The only driver on the circuit this year that has completed 100% of all possible laps, a testimonial not only to his driving skills on the racetrack and his ability to stay out of trouble, but the tremendous preparation that goes into that machine.
When Mike Eddy led one lap of the Milwaukee Mile, Scott Hansen dropping the left side tires into the dirt. When Mike Eddy led one lap of this race, it was the sixth consecutive race that he has led at least one lap. Actually, at least 26 laps. His worst performance in terms of leading laps came last week at Calgary. There is Harold Fair.
The Mac Tool Chevy of Harold Fair, who's had a series of problems this season. He's been fast for the last several years. It took him 109 starts to ever win an ASA event. Since then, he's always been a front runner, but he's off the pace and slowing. He'll bring that machine on pit road, and I hope he makes it to his pit stall.
It's going to be touch and go. Harold's best finish, by the way, this year was a fourth, one of the Canadian races, Cayuga, the 5/8 mile up there. Well, first place has calmed down, and Trickle has laid claim to the runner-up spot, and Scott Hansen's had to settle, at least right now, for third.
Mike Eddy continues to lead. The last time we were on the Milwaukee Mile with the ASA cars, he started way back in 17th position and won on that afternoon. Johnny Benson, who's currently in the fourth position, was runner-up. And once again, Trickle closes in behind him, and now it's Hansen that is losing several car lengths.
In fifth position is the Illinois veteran, Joe Scheer. He had a solid qualifying run. He's always a threat. Running in sixth position is Jeff Neal in the Xerox Buick. And in ninth place on the right-hand side of your screen is Ted Musgrave. And right now he's being challenged by the Wiley Sneaker.
Those two drivers both started well back in the pack. Musgrave historically has qualified well here at Milwaukee, but he has had a difficult time finishing races here. He's never been victorious on the Milwaukee Mile, and frankly, I don't think this is one of Bob Seneca's favorite racetracks either. Both of them having a good afternoon this afternoon.
Seneca does have three career wins here, but as Rob pointed out, ASA has raced here 22 times, and Bob has probably competed in just about every one of them, so in Bob Seneca terms, that's not a good winning or hitting percentage.
No, it isn't. And that time as they came down the straightaway, you can see right in front of them the blue and white car number 90 of Kent Stauffer, the Flex Technologies Kinetic Industries machine. Kent had very great hopes. Last time we saw him on television at Nashville, he ran as high as third before fading late in the going. And he has a Ford engine, and a lot of people felt that that would be the one to be here today.
Stauffer 8, Musgrave 9, Seneca 10. First, Mike Eddy. Second continues to be Dick Trickle. Scott Hansen runs third. Johnny Benson is fourth. And Joe Scheer is in the fifth position.
Again, we're riding with Scott Hansen, and this time he does ease up alongside of Dick Trickle. And perhaps he thinks maybe, Larry, it's wise to try to get around Trickle before Eddy builds too significant a lead. He knows that Mike Eddy will run just as hard as he can as long as the car keeps going in the right direction.
Ralph is standing by with one of the first real disappointments of the afternoon, a man who's twice been runner-up in the points. Ralph?
Harold, obviously you didn't want to get out this early again. What went wrong with the car today?
Well, we did a lot of working yesterday, put a lot of laps on the car, and I think we just kind of tired the motor out. We lost the cylinder.
We've gotten just a few laps in. How does this Milwaukee Mile racetrack seem today?
Well, it's a little rough on the low side going into number one and number three. But I think it's going to be good racing out there because you move up a lane and there's you can go.
Well, Harold told me at Calgary after the race last weekend that he had 1,700 laps on the engine that was in that race car, a testament to the durability. Maybe with the lack of time that they had in between races, he was not able to do anything to that engine.
Runner-up battle heating up once again. That's Scott Hansen, the stalker, and Dick Trickle, the stalkee. Trickle, surprisingly, is running a lane that none of the other top cars are driving in. Dick Trickle is about a half a lane, sometimes a lane off of the bottom of the track, and he keeps opening the door for Scott Hansen. Scott Hansen sees that opening, but just can't get through.
Much of the day yesterday, practice and qualifying was run under overcast conditions, and I think that some of these drivers may have anticipated a need for chassis adjustments prior to the start of this race. Maybe Trickle needs a little bit of fine-tuning at the first pit stop.
Or could it be the other way around? Has Dick Trickle set up for the end of the race, and is he in better shape for laps 150 through 200? We'll have to wait and see.
Well, you can see Mike Eddy already in some lap traffic on a very large racetrack for the ASA competitors. This is currently the longest track on the schedule. And Gary St. Amant brings the Ray Vesta Chevrolet on pit road. And that's not a good sign this early in the going. Obviously, not a scheduled stop, and it appears that he'll go down to the end of pit wall and perhaps bring the machine behind. What a disappointment for the driver from Ohio.
They have been struggling with engine problems for the last 3 weeks. They told me yesterday, Rob, that this was actually a compilation of two engines. They had lost two in the last couple races, and they put them together and came up with this one, and the hybrid didn't work either. Back up front. Tim Steele's involved. Dave Jackson, there's a small flash fire as Tim Steele, a Michigan driver, and Dave Jackson from the Cincinnati, Ohio area, have come together, and there's still fire on the racing surface.
Steele's day last Sunday ended the same way up in Canada as he backed car number 85 hard into the wall coming off the second turn, and it's the same place that has plagued him here again today at Milwaukee. Jackson's car appears to be the more seriously damaged of the two. Tim appears to be driving his machine away from the scene of the accident.
Tim Steele in car number 85, the HS Dye Texana Bar and Grill Special, has now crashed in three successive races. None of them really have been what you would refer to as a tremendously hard impact, but certainly enough to interrupt your day, Rob.
Well, we just catch the tail end of that. I can see a wheel bouncing up against the wall. It's a chromed wheel. It's the right front of Dave Jackson. That's how I know it's his. And it appeared to me that maybe the lug nuts came loose on that. That is a very unusual incident to have happen on a stock car bodied piece of equipment like that.
And we picked up that replay after it had begun. You have to assume that, as you pointed out, that wheel coming off of Jackson's car precipitated that, and Tim just got swept up in it. One of those things that you fear about when you have to start in the back of the pack. Tim Steele started this race way back in 31st position on characteristic form, and he paid the price.
Tim Steele's Texana machine having a tough time here at the Milwaukee Mile. You see the hood up on the number 85. The crew is going to work in the brake area. He had reported that he did not have any brakes and is bringing the car in after the incident earlier in this race. The back side of the car, gentlemen, is completely pushed in from where he got backed into the wall. Tim Steele, an unfortunate afternoon here at the Milwaukee Mile.
Ralph, we'd also like to pass on a hello to one of the best ASA racing fans, I am told, from coast to coast, Marie Eaton. Actually, Larry Harris's mom. And Marie, Larry had engine problems yesterday. He was unable to qualify for this race, but he passes his greetings along. Marie has been ill. She used to frequent every one of the ASA races, didn't miss a one. So we hope that things turn around for you. We're looking forward to seeing you back at one of these ASA races. And incidentally, Marie and others, in case you were wondering, we would like to remind you that this telecast is a copyrighted production of Group 5 Sports, a division of Group 5 Sales Incorporated. Any use, rebroadcast, or other transmission of this telecast without the written consent of Group 5 Sports is prohibited.
Well, another tough break for the folks at Team Cuz, the informal Team Cuz. Gary St. Amant, your car gave up the ghost a little while ago.
Yeah, Ralph. We was hoping to have a good run here today with the A1 Auto Service Rebessa Chevrolet, but horsepower has always been a little bit of a problem for us, and we come here. We broke a good motor up in Calgary. We come here hoping to get through today, but I guess it was all for naught. So.
Well, your partner, Tim Steele's got problems. That leaves you guys with one more Team Cuz member.
We'll be rooting for Cuz Glenn out there. Hopefully the 66 Basestone car can put her up front for Team Cuz.
All right, that's Gary St. Amant, an unfortunate ending for his day as well.
Well, Mike Eddy has dominated this race. He qualified on the pole, and we asked him earlier this week, what would it take to win at Milwaukee? What would it take to win the pole?
It takes consistency. Qualifying and racing is two different things here. Usually I'm known for the racing and not for qualifying, but maybe this weekend I can get both of them down pat.
Well, you saw just before Ralph was talking to Gary St. Amant, the machine on the hooks of Dave Jackson in car number 45. He's one of those drivers that probably wishes the cameras had been rolling last weekend instead of this weekend. His finest ASA performance in his short career, as he finished third in the Players 500 out in Calgary. And he did it in fine style after the last pit stop. Dave was about 6.5 seconds behind Bob Seneca and Jay Sauter, who finished ahead of him at the checkered flag. He closed within 2.5 seconds.
Well, who said race drivers can?
We're there right now, see him?
Only drive. Ralph, but you're standing right by there. Tim Steele doing work inside with his clothes still on.
Yeah, that's right, Larry. We were talking to the truck there. That's why he probably heard us a little bit sooner than we wanted to. Timmy Steele is in the car doing all that he can to help the crew. They got a bunch of guys working up here on the front end of the car doing everything they can to get this Texana HS Dye entry back into the field. Timmy looking around trying to do everything he can as the crew is working on the brakes in the front end feverishly trying to get him back in.
Tim, a young driver who comes from a very successful business family, but a lot of people, I don't think, give him the credit that he deserves for his mechanical skills. Tim was formerly a world-class jet ski racer and motocross racer, choosing instead the stock cars of ASA.
Incidentally, we're here at Milwaukee, and it's very historic for the Indianapolis cars as the one-lap signal comes up for the field to be ready the next time around. We're here with all this history of Indianapolis cars, and we're looking at a bright red number 85. Do you know where Tim Steele's number came from?
I don't.
Gordon Johncock was the scourge of Southern Michigan, Northern Indiana, and Ohio in the Super Modified division just before he moved to the USAC Sprint cars in a bright red number 85. His number came from Gordon Johncock when Gordon was a Super Modified driver.
And I'd have to check, but I'm not sure that Tim Steele was even born yet when Gordon Johncock was Rookie of the Year.
That amazed me, because I agree with you, Rob. When Gordon was doing well in the Super Modified division, that goes back to the very early 1960s, I doubt that Tim was around. And as you pointed out, only when Gordon moved to the IndyCars, maybe Tim was born at that time.
Just beginning to realize what it means that I was around.
Hey, we're ready to go this time around. You can see Mike Eddy, if he could, he would be rubbing his hands together. Hey, I'm ready to go racing. A true racing driver is not happy under caution. They like to go fast. It's Eddy, Trickle, Hansen, Benson, Joe Scheer, sixth place up for grabs between Glenn Allen and Jeff Neal. In eighth place, Ted Musgrave. Ninth is Kent Stauffer. And in tenth is Bob Seneca.
Right behind him is Jay Sauter. And Jay is beginning to move back up through the pack after a poor qualifying run from yesterday.
Oh, and look at this. Dick Trickle has moved to the inside. Remember, he was running that outside lane all afternoon and finally has decided, hey, maybe I ought to try that.
It may have been a long time since these two guys have gone door to door like this, but they sure have done it for hundreds of laps in their careers.
Look at Seneca, or look at Benson, rather. Apparently his keys are not, your keys are not weighing him down.
Don't let me forget that, would you not? Benson out to third position. Scott Hansen is up on the high side, and I don't know, Larry, the handle may be going away for Hansen in the early going. Now he closes right in behind Benson. Johnny is right there to challenge, as we said, in that car that has never been run on a big track.
Everybody wiggling up front. It looked like Hansen was sliding, but I do believe it was just the camera moving its direction that it was pointed. But everybody wiggled a little bit coming out of corner number two, and things are really heating up front. Apparently, Mike Eddy has slowed down.
Eddy trying to keep that Pontiac in front of four, now five, six Chevrolets trailing him. Again, Trickle trying the low side of the racetrack. It's Mike Eddy keeping that black Pontiac out in front. Look at Hansen, goes even wider, and now Joe Scheer comes to the low side. Scheer will wrestle fourth position, apparently away from Scott Hansen, as the Delta Faucets machine out of the Baker Motorsports shop is apparently having a bit of a handling problem.
Well, Russ Ebert is the crew chief for Dick Trickle, and Dick is showing some newfound speed here after the yellow flag. But first, before we go to Ralph down there, oh, very sad story. This is Glenn Allen Jr. He was having a very good race. He was running a fast top six. They've had problem after problem after problem after winning the opening race. Here's Glenn Allen now back up front. It's still Eddy, Trickle, and John Benson now has moved into third. And now, Ralph, now we'll go down to you and talk about Dick Trickle.
Well, as you mentioned, Russ Ebert is his crew chief. Russ, how is Dick's car handling right now?
We're just a little bit loose. We need to adjust a little bit as we go here. Our car is just a little loose getting in. And during that yellow, our left rear grew a little bit. The car was a little tighter for a few laps, but as we go, we're a little loose, and we're going to adjust for it and cut the split down a little bit in.
Had you set up for the early portion of the race, or were you planning on coming in strong at the end?
We should run real good at the end. I mean, our tire program is geared to tighten the car as the day goes on. I guess we didn't expect to get loose quite this quick, but I think we'll be all right.
Well, if Dick Trickle is able to hold on to a loose race car the way he is right now, guys, you can only imagine what it's going to be like when they get it exactly the way they want it.
Absolutely, Ralph, and that was a very interesting explanation as to why Dick Trickle was faster after the yellow flag and why the car performed differently. Tire grew during the yellow flag, meaning that it had more of a stagger. It was tilting more to the left, kept it down in the bottom easier.
Unquestionably, the fastest car on the racetrack for right now is the Wisconsin Aviation Chevrolet of Ted Musgrave. Ted, of course, leading the NASCAR Rookie of the Year points in the Winston Cup Series. Very interesting story about this guy from Wisconsin a couple of years ago. He won an ASA event, told his crew to go ahead and go back to the motel. He got there were no rooms left. He went out and crawled in the race car and spent the night in the machine that had just carried him to a checkered flag at Raceway Park.
Teddy Musgrave, one of the Badger battalion that has entered here today. They came 12 strong. Trickle, Musgrave, Hanson, Sauter, Ziegler, Vogel, Burgess. And they wanted to show the rest of the ASA crowd how it was done. They consider this to be their home turf, and the Badger battalion is trying to do the trick today.
Ted often uses a driving style that a lot of people feel really doesn't work well at Milwaukee. Drives hard into the turns, and usually they say that scrubs off speed here. Now there's Scott Hanson. He's still sitting right behind Johnny Benson. We can see out the backside, he's really getting some heat now from Musgrave. Larry, look at Benson's line, turn number one. He's able to hold that machine right down to the bottom, and that's an indication that that car is working very well.
Looking directly at third place, Johnny Benson Jr. from Grand Rapids, Michigan. There he is from the outside of corner number one. He follows Dick Trickle and race leader Mike Eddy. Ralph has one of our sad stories of the afternoon. Ralph, you have to talk to Glenn Allen Jr. early again.
Well, Larry, the Team Cuz story has gone from bad to worse. Glenn Allen Jr. was the last car running out there. Glenn, what was it that put your number 66 out?
We ended up breaking a motor. I think we broke a valve spring when I entered turn one. So it's our third motor in 3 weeks, so we're going to have to redo what we're doing and try to get things going again. But just bad luck keeping us, you know. The car's run well, and we had a good shot today to win.
You mentioned that you've had motor problems. Any idea where the problem is, why you're having such tough luck?
We actually don't know, but I think it's in the valve train. We broke three valves in 3 weeks, so it's something in that order.
Well, Glenn Allen's going to keep going at it, guys. He's going to try and get it ready for the next race.
Team Cuz, Glenn Allen, Tim Steele, and Gary St. Amant. It's that informal fraternity of three of the younger drivers, three of the younger hard drivers on the ASA trail. They call themselves Team Cuz.
At the beginning of the year, it looked like they were going to be a threesome to reckon with in every event. At Columbus Motor Speedway, it was Glenn Allen Jr. winning his first race ever. St. Amant gave him fits, so did Steele. Steele looked like he had the Salem race in the bag before the engine went sour late in the going. At the beginning, Larry, I did say that I thought we'd see a new first-time winner here at Milwaukee. Johnny Benson ran so well in the spring race here, I thought he was the guy to beat today.
Speaking about Team Cuz, there's Tim Steele. You saw him hard at work inside the cockpit doing labor, hard rock labor inside, getting that car back on the track. It took him about 10 green flag laps, but Tim Steele is back out.
Tim, as you mentioned, having some help this weekend from the people at Texana Bar and Grill. The reason we mention that, it's a Nashville-based operation. It's the first in what those people hope will be a chain of restaurants. And if that one is an indication of what the rest will be like, folks, you want one of those in your town, because we had a ball at Texana while in Nashville.
40 laps are now complete of 200. We've gone 40 miles. We anticipate two pit stops by all the drivers, unless we have a large number of caution flags. We'll be back. We're back at West Allis, Wisconsin, a suburb of Milwaukee. This is the legendary Milwaukee Mile. Looking at first, second, third, and fourth, and right now, second place is definitely up for grabs. That's Johnny Benson Jr. on the outside. It looked like he had the advantage on the veteran Dick Trickle going into corner number three, but Trickle hunkered her down and stayed right on the white line and moved back into contention.
Well, as they battle for that second spot, Mike Eddy is again pulled out to a slight advantage, about 10 car lengths. And look at Musgrave right in behind Trickle. Benson with a slight edge as they head out of turn two and down the back straightaway.
And now Scott Hanson indicates he would like to join the fray. What's going on here is that both Musgrave and John Benson Jr. are faster than Trickle. But Trickle is running just the perfect line, and neither one of them can get by.
The mile master, Dick Trickle, has forced both of those young drivers to the outside groove, and I think it's kept them both from being able to make the pass.
Now let's see what Musgrave can do. He gets a bit of an advantage on John Benson Jr. Rob, you mentioned about 10 laps ago, you felt that Ted was the fastest car on the track. There he is on the inside of Benson. This is what Johnny Benson sees right now. I hope he's looking forward, though.
Musgrave used the move of Trickle to keep Benson to the high side to take advantage of John himself. Ted is now up into the third position and appears to be closing on Trickle. And I'm sure now Benson's going to sit there and say, okay, fella, let's see what you try to do with that guy.
Yeah, I gave it my best shot. Now it's your turn.
Couple of youngsters, Benson and Hanson, unable to get around Dick Trickle. It's been since 1988, I believe, since he won here on the Milwaukee Mile. But his last ASA win came at Anderson Speedway, a totally different racetrack from this one.
Well, certainly the car to watch is the one right behind the leading duo. Double digits are at the top right now. The double eight of Mike Eddy leads it. The double nine of Dick Trickle. Incidentally, I did ask him, why does he use the number 99? Everyone knows, well, that's Dick Trickle's number, and it has been for 25 years. And he said, well, Larry, when I was a teenager, I was riding to a racetrack in the back of a pickup truck with a bunch of guys, and we were talking about dreaming of being a great racing driver. He said, if I ever drive race cars, I want number one or number 99. I want to be first on that list or last. He said, next year I started to drive, and one was already taken, so I got 99.
And now we'll look at the margin between first and second. It's minute at 0.6 seconds. Dick Trickle, a very colorful, I guess, is the best way to describe him, racing character. And the first couple of seasons that I traveled with the American Speed Association as the announcer, they clued me in very quickly. Don't worry about seeing Dick Trickle running around the halls of the motel the night before the race. He judges the number of hours of sleep that he needs by the number of laps in the race. A 300-lap race, 3 hours of sleep.
Yeah, it makes sense to me. His math is good. Okay, we're going to check this interval one more time between first and second. Is Trickle closing in? There's Eddie. Trips the clock. Whoa. 0.1 seconds. I'd say he is.
One of the concerns that I had going into this race, historically, Milwaukee has been the kind of racetrack where an ASA competition, a driver will somehow find a bit of an edge and pull away, run away, hide. I was concerned about an uncompetitive race today. I needn't have worried.
The surface here at the Milwaukee Mile is an old one, but because the track is relatively flat, it's still in good shape. But Ralph, the drivers tell me that it's abrasive. What can you tell us about the tire compound?
Well, tires are always the story, as you know, Larry. 1701 compound tires will be used on the right side. Now, you would normally think they'd use the same thing on the left side. No, sir, not here at Milwaukee. 1432s are on the left side of the car. 1701s on the right side are a harder compound. That side of the car takes more abuse here at the Milwaukee Mile. So they are making them run the harder compound on the right side, and they can get away with the softer compound on the left side. And that's the way it'll be here today at Milwaukee.
Well, Ralph, we have a
fun again, I think.
Caution one more time for Steve Barnes, the Mackinac, Illinois driver. This is his second incident. Cause for the second yellow flag by him today. Steve is struggling here. He had his best race, I believe, in ASA history last week. He finished 10th up in Canada, and that was somewhat of a surprise. They were all pumped up about this week. They felt, geez, we finally made ourselves competitive, but it's been a tough day.
Calgary was the kind of weekend that if you just survived it, you thought you had earned a moral victory. Barnes and his crew chief, a guy who used to do some ASA racing, were just ecstatic with that finish. You know, sometimes you get a clue from what a guy says on race morning, what you might expect from him. And he said, man, I'm scared to death out there today. Now, I appreciate his honesty, but maybe there was a bit of that involved in what's been happening in today. In Steve's defense, he's never seen a racetrack this size.
This is a one-mile racetrack, twice as large as the normal ASA racetrack. All these guys up front, they're veterans on it. Ted Musgrave and Dick Trickle, of course, who are running second, third, run the Winston Cup circuit, so they're very comfortable with tracks 1 mile in length. But for some of the ASA drivers, particularly drivers like Steve, this is a new experience, and it can be extremely challenging. We'll be back. Back at Milwaukee, you're looking at a live shot of Tim Steele, car number 85, the Marne or Grand Rapids area Michigan driver in his HS Dye Engineering Texana Bar and Grill race car. And heavy smoke coming out now. The field went green momentarily just one lap ago. There is Tim on the right-hand side of the screen emitting a great deal of smoke, a smoke screen, if you will, for the drivers behind him. But an interesting thing has happened here, and it may be very sad for drivers like Ken Schrader. The green came out, I believe, reasonably suddenly. I don't think all the drivers on the track anticipated it. There is Joe Shearer, and Ralph will get to you in just a second. I want to make a comment that Ken Schrader was in the pits, Ralph, as the green dropped. I think he went down a lap. You're with Joe, and Joe has got some problems.
Joe does have some problems. Joe, what went wrong with your car?
Something happened to the engine. I don't know if it broke a piston or a rock arm or something. Going down the backstretch, it let out a puff of smoke out of the breathers, and it started misting on one cylinder, so we're done for the day, I guess.
We've heard a few guys having problems with engines today. Is there something about this racetrack or the weather we're having here today that she could possibly be causing engine woes?
No, I don't think so. It's just one of those things that happens once in a while. I don't think the weather or the track's got anything to do with it. It just happens now and then.
Joe Scheer, who probably is at his very best on quarter and half mile racetracks, is out of this one. Here's the top five, one quarter of the way through. Eddie Trickle, Johnny Benson, Scott Hansen, and Jeff Neal perseveres through all of this confusion and holds in fifth position. There is the race leader, Mike Eddie. Dick Trickle running in second spot. No problem surfacing for either of those two drivers, at least from what we can see from up here. But then again, neither one of them are carrying an in-car camera this week. But our in-car cameras have given us some terrific shots. They've been running up front.
Larry, what turned out to be a curse for Ken Schrader was a blessing in disguise for Ted Musgrave. You noticed in that graphic, the driver who moved into third position was missing from the top five. He had elected to come in for a stop very late in that caution period. We went back to green, and he was just coming off pit road, so he was able to come right back to the tail as we prepare to go back to green.
And we'll check on Schrader and see, indeed, if he did lose a lap, but it certainly appeared that way visually, and if so, that's very disappointing because Ken Schrader was certainly expected to be among the drivers contending for victory today at the Milwaukee Mile.
The field files by, and you can see not only Musgrave and car number 98, but the 84 machine of Bob Seneca also was on pit road during that most recent caution period. I'm not sure. Was that a good idea or not so good idea to come in so late and leave these leaders an opportunity to pull away?
If you were watching, you saw Musgrave go by in the royal blue and robin's egg blue painted number 98. The number on it is yellow gold. Ted is trying to work his way back toward the front. There is Ted. Speaking about being lively, we are live from the Milwaukee Mile, and look at lively Ted Musgrave moving the outside as he moves to the cars currently running between 20th and 30th position.
Going to the high side of Scott Kaiser's car number 24. Now he'll try to go in between Kaiser. I believe that's Lee Farthing's car number 30, the driver up this weekend from South Carolina.
And there's Seneca also. He's stuck back there in the back of the back. And Seneca threads the needle, we think. Musgrave has to get out of the throttle as he tries to work his round way around Kaiser. Kaiser moves low. He's in the middle. There goes Musgrave low. Seneca high. Ralph, you missed something. They both got by. You got an interview for us. Go ahead.
Well, the final Team Cuz member out for the day, Tim Steele at Texana Drill Machine, had finally called it an afternoon. What happened to you?
Well, earlier on in the race when we got in that wreck there, Steve Burgess, he must have got a flat tire or something and came in the pits, and he's lapped down. I guess he's getting a little anxious. Got into Dave Jackson, and I happened to be right there, unfortunately, and here we are then. Now the motor died.
Tough afternoon all the way around for the informal Team Cubs.
Well, we were late getting to the incident involving Jackson. There we got a bird's eye perspective. Of course, that's just one opinion.
Serious crash in corner number three. That is Lee Farthing, his second incident of the day, and Tim Fedewa. This car has had life both as a Ford and a Chevrolet this year. It's the Chevy today, and Tim Fedewa and Lee Farthing have had serious contact entering corner number three.
Tim came into this race as the leading rookie of the year contender. He has now climbed out of that badly maimed yellow car number 55, and you can see the way he's taking the gloves off. He's disgusted with what might have transpired right here. Look at Farthing. Oh. He's closed in behind Steve Barnes and literally turns right into the side of Tim Fedewa, and that was a hard wall contact for both of those drivers. Inexperience. There's no other way, Larry, to describe that than Lee Farthing just simply didn't realize that there were faster cars coming on the outside.
Boy, that's a tough one. You certainly hate to see anybody get involved in an incident. Of course, that is part of motor racing. But for somebody like Tim, obviously very unhappy with Lee, saying, do you not have mirrors? Were you looking? What was going on? Did you blow a tire? Tell me what happened. They've had such a struggle this year, that DNR Racing Enterprises machine. They've worked so hard to put together what they have, and for an incident like that to take place, and that was a very hard hit. The initial impact itself was serious enough, and then both of them crashing into the outside wall.
Early in the season, Tim with two top 10 finishes, those coming at Salem Speedway, and also here at Milwaukee, like this racetrack, finished eighth here back in May. And Tim is the kind of young guy that you really want to watch for the future. He's I think now right back around 12th or 13th in the overall national point standings. He's still the leading rookie, but the way he's performed on the racetrack, he very easily could be in the top five or six.
And he comes from a great racing tradition. His father and uncle, both racing drivers, very, very good in their own right. They drove open wheelers, ironically enough. His father, Butch Fidowa, was one of the terrors of the super modified circuit in Michigan. Here is another racing family from southern Michigan with roots in the super modified stock cars. This is John Benson Jr.
Johnny Benson, as you said, Larry, in getting on right side tires. They're now working on the left side. Remember, we got two different sets of compounds here. You want to make sure you grab the right set of tires when you go to the other side of the race car. They put the harder compound 1701 Goodyears on the right side and the softer compound tires on the left side. Fill them up, send them back out.
So Johnny Benson Jr. gets out with no threat of loss of lap. And incidentally, we've had timing and scoring check on Ken Schrader, and the first report we got back from them was positive. Schrader remains on the lead lap. 62 of 200 laps officially completed the top five. Eddie Trickle, Hansen, Neal, and Jay Sauter. This is Milwaukee Brewer, Buck Country, Packer Country, of course. Today, Stock Car Country, and right now, this man, Dennis Lampman, a native of this area, is liking it.
All you can see from this view is the headshot. Dennis Lampman is a big, big fella. I know the car right behind him, the blue and green car number 91 of Tom Harrington. Harrington's a former professional football player with the New Orleans Saints, but a guy he probably wouldn't want to butt helmets with would be Lampman, the guy right in front of him. This Wisconsin driver blew an engine in practice yesterday. Didn't even get to qualify. He's come from 32nd to now run 9th.
Dennis lists his home as Racine, Wisconsin. This is the A1 service barricade flasher. So I guess those are the people you have to blame when you're driving up and down the highway and you got to dodge those construction sites. We say that, of course, in loving jest. There is a close-up of the remains of the DNR Racing Enterprises number 55 that Tim Peterloff just took him through the outside wall.
An all-around disappointing afternoon for Fita, where they'd hoped to have the engine ready in their Ford. It wasn't done in time. They had to campaign the Chevy. Tim, nonetheless, had been turning in a good performance, had moved himself into the top 10 at the time of the involvement with Farthing on the racetrack.
And again, in case you just joined us, what happened was that Tim came in contact with Lee. There was a very hard collision between the two cars on the racing surface first, and then both of them crashed into the outside wall. The cars are going up in the air, almost getting upside down, an indication that the speeds they're traveling here at the Milwaukee Mile. And speaking about being at the Milwaukee Mile, the most veteran of this racetrack is Dick Trickle. Let's hear from him.
Well, first of all, you know, being ready and having everything prepared proper, you know, order finish first, you must first finish. That added up with the lap times I got here and the amount of laps I have experience. And I think I run just a little bit different pattern here than the average guy. And I think I got the track figured out well and get the chassis hooked up to the racetrack. It's a combination of everything.
At the lap 64 mark, 10 cars at this point are behind the wall. That's an indication they might come back. The number 71 of John Wilson, the 81 car of Harold Bear, Gary St. Amant, Gary Jackson, 66 of Glenn Allen, the car number 57 of Dennis Robertson, the only Canadian driver winner of today's race, Tim Steele, Joe Shear, Lee Farthing, the 55 car that you just saw of Tim Fidowa, and car number 28 makes up the list of 10 cars behind the pit wall. Well, we're back to green again, and Mike Eddy finds himself in a familiar position. So far, he has been the lead jammer all afternoon. If this were roller derby, and for a couple of laps here today, it's looked just like that with people colliding into outside retaining walls. But through it all, Eddie has held on.
He sure has. For a plague-filled first third of this race, I'm surprised that a lot of these drivers have not elected to come on pit road.
Well, some of them came in during one of the yellow flags about 10 laps ago, and it almost cost them. ASA had the track cleaned up within about a lap and a half, and when they were ready to go, they went green. Some guys were caught napping in the pits, but apparently all of the front-running cars were able to get back out. They lost track position, but stayed on that all-important lead lap.
May have just been a shadow, but that time as Mike Eddy headed out of turn number two and down the back straightaway, it did appear that the rear tail panel on that Pontiac car number 88 had quite a bit of oil. covering the right side of the Nationwide's logo. It does appear that way. There has been no indication from the pits that there might be problems with that car, but we'll want to continue to monitor Mike Eddy's progress on the racetrack. Milwaukee, one of only two tracks, Larry, also, we ought to point out to the race fans, where during any caution period, the drivers are permitted to change all four tires. At most facilities, they can only change any two, and that creates some strategic thinking when the cars come on pit road. Here, every time they come in, because of the high speeds attained at the end of the straightaway, approaching 150 miles an hour, they are permitted to change all four.
Me and my shadow. Car number 88, car number 99, Eddie and Trickle. Mike Eddy has won 31 times in his ASA career, and Dick Trickle, 29. Trickle's got to be smarting because he was ranked third on the all-time list, and Eddy moved past him this year. Speaking about Musgrave, yep, he's still running competitive.
Ted has picked up a number of positions since the last caution flag. He's got fresher tires in the cars he's now passing. He's just made his way past Dennis Lampman. As we pan the field down the back straightaway, you can see a couple of cars that we really haven't mentioned much this afternoon. Jay Sauter in car number one, and also the Jeff Neal car in car number five. They're hanging tough and in the lead lap. There is Lampman continuing to run on that lead circuit and in the top 10, but now I think beginning to fall back just a bit.
There's a close-up of Dennis Lampman in the orange car number nine.
There you can see as the field goes down into turn number one, it's still Eddy and Trickle, but suddenly Hansen and Jeff Neal have closed right in behind. Jeff Neal a week ago at Calgary was by far the fastest car on the racetrack, but he was running with an experimental $15,000 ignition system. There was some high-frequency radio interference that they feel may have come from the airport, so he's gone back to the old distributor and standard ignition. It's working for him so far.
Okay, Ralph right now has moved down to Mike Eddy's pit. We'll have check with Howard Thomas, his crew chief, and find out if Mike has slowed down or if Trickle is going faster.
Howard, is he slowing down at all, or is Dick Trickle just getting that much quicker?
Well, Dick caught up with him, and they're running pretty even right now. I think they're both just kind of taking it easy to save the tires. Neither one of them have pitted yet, and I would imagine next yellow will both be pitting.
If you don't get a yellow soon, just how long can you go?
Well, you should be able to run here, I would guess, about 110 miles on a tank of fuel.
A couple of old wily veterans playing a real strategy game now, Larry.
Well, Howdy Thomas is a real character. He formerly was Bob Seneker's crew chief, but when Bob hooked up with car owner Leroy Troop, Howdy was left without a team. Didn't take Mike Eddy long to pick him up. And suddenly, Jeff Neal has come into the forefront of our focus. That's Z-Rex Victor Ruggles machine, car number five. Now, Ruggles is mentioned as one of the sponsors. That is an engine builder, and they are known for extremely high horsepower, strong power plants.
Jeff Neal has come from about seventh or eighth position, a quiet seventh or eighth, but very competitive. He zoomed around the outside of Scott Hansen at number 53. And the 12th-ranked driver in the current ASA point standings is showing, as he did a week ago, a lot of speed. Jeff has no wins in his ASA career, but is one of those young drivers that a lot of people think certainly has a shot at picking up that first victory sometime soon in his career. One of the sons working for his dad is Harold Bear Jr. He's with Ralph.
Harold, can Jeff Neal get that elusive win here today? You think he got the right car for it?
Well, we've got the Xerox car hooked up pretty good. We're just going to sit it out, loosen it up a little bit on the first pit stop, and see how things go after that. So I feel we have a good shot today.
The other leaders, Mike Eddy and Dick Trickle, haven't pitted yet. You mentioned that you've already gotten some gas. How's the strategy going to play out later on? How do you think that will affect you as this race progresses?
Well, I think it'll be good because we can come in one time for tires. If the car's right, we won't have to come back in, and we can stay out there up front all day and hopefully get the lead and pull away.
Well, gentlemen, maybe the young guys got something for the old people here today.
Harold Fair Jr. used to work for his father. There was a change over the winter. There's a family connection there. You can tell us all about that.
Scott Hansen has a good view of the back end of Jeff Neal's Buick, car number five, and we've not seen the Buicks be very competitive in the last year or two, actually since 1990 when Mike Eddy made the switch this year from Buick to Pontiac, and Jeff seems to be picking up the gauntlet for that mark.
In these in-car shots, you can see just how, I'm going to use the word unstable, but yet under control, but truly unstable, the cars are. from the overhead shots, everything looks smooth and very comfortable, very relaxed. But when you go inside, you can see how much work these drivers have to do. The cars are running at a constant speed around this one-mile oval, easily approaching 100 miles per hour in the corners here, and as you mentioned earlier, up to 130, 140 on the straightaways. And the cars do move around. They do slide. And the idea to preserve the tires is to limit the sliding as much as possible, yet still continue to go as fast.
Even the in-car camera really doesn't give you a good perception of what that driver is feeling. I had an opportunity to go around this racetrack in a passenger car at about 55 miles an hour. And from your easy chair, the track looks wide and flat. But remember, it's an old asphalt surface, and it's full of bumps and ruts and grooves, and it is very rough. It's taxing on the driver. Without the benefit of banking, only 6 degrees of banking in the turns, it's also much more tiring on them physically.
Well, it's been at times a five-car fast break up front. Most of the afternoon, at least 4 cars. The players have changed. The constant has remained Mike Eddy up front. All this commotion going on behind Mike, and at times it looked like Dick Trickle was going to pass him. 84 mile per hour average speed at this point, 78 laps in. Remember, we've had a couple of lengthy cautions. At times it looked like Ted Musgrave was going to pass him, but so far no one's been able to get the job done, and maybe Jeff Neal would be taking a shot at it in the next couple of laps.
If anybody will do it aggressively, it's Neal. He was the rookie of the year in 1988, and he'd love to meet these veterans in front of him. Things have not gone well for Jeff since then. 1989 and 1990, both seasons filled with crashes and failed power plants. But it appears now, with the affiliation with Harold Fair Jr., that things are turning Jeff's direction.
Oh.
And look at Trickle sideways.
Dick Trickle losing the handle momentarily there in corner number 4. It was a bit of an unusual place for that to happen. Usually, if you're going to lose control, or if the car is going to break loose because it hit the marbles or a tire's going down, it'll happen going into the corner, not coming out.
Again, we ride with Scott Hansen. Now all we can see is blue, but maybe we'll get a glimpse momentarily of car number 99 and see this time through turn 4 if Trickle may be experiencing some serious handling problems. Neil's the one that's drifting out.
Well, you know what Neil was thinking? I'm going to sit back here, and if this guy does that again, I got second place this lap.
I think you're right. Sorted out again for the moment as they head down in turn number 1. Mike Eddy again beginning to stretch things out ever so slightly. Trickle running way down low.
The point standings coming into today's race, Bob Seneca, who is still in this field. Oh, Kent Stauffer slows. Kent Stauffer, who performed so well in our last televised race and has truly become one of the consistent regulars at ASA, has come to a slow speed here on the racetrack. The yellow flag is out, I believe, and we do not know at this point whether that is for Kent or if he is indeed just admonishing the yellow flag.
At least to this point in time, the folks in Dearborn, the Ford people, have not elected to put as much support behind the ASA racing program as their General Motors counterparts. Kent hoping that will change. He's flown the banner valiantly for Ford for a number of seasons, and he really felt that this year he had things together. He's kind of pioneering the development of that Ford V6 engine program. He's entitled to run a carburetor, a 750 carburetor, that's a little bit bigger than the General Motors products. He's finally figured out how to get fuel to go through it.
For a fact, though, Rob, the Ford Motor Company people up in Dearborn, we know that they are giving some serious looks at this. They are involved in that DNR Enterprises project. They've got people like Earl Gertie working on their new engine, so perhaps we'll see some more of that mark in ASA competition in the very near future. Now, we are standing by in the pits of the race leader, and it sure looks to me like, Ralph Shaheen, you've got to be ready for a pit stop. Yep, the train is forming, coming off of corner number 4. They go to the reduced pit lane speed, and here comes Mike Eddy. Take it away, Ralph Shaheen.
The crew is waiting for him, Larry. Howard Thomas has got the guys' tires in hand, gas cans in hand. The number sign is out. He sweeps in just in front of Jeff Neal's crew, and they go to work on this car on the right side first. We had a chance to ask Howard while they were waiting for Mike to come in if they would need more gas. He said, maybe. I said, how about tires, Howard? Can you go all the way with tires? That we don't know yet. Maybe we can. You'll remember at Nashville, they thought they had tires that were only good for a third place finish, and Mike Eddy drove the daylights out of that car to finish up as high as he could. He might try it again here this afternoon. A true testament to how tough Mike Eddy will be. Dick Trickle doing the same thing at the other end of the pits. We'll have to wait and see what his crew chief says about how far they can go. it is really getting to be a strategy game down here between these two veterans.
Well, Ralph, Dick Trickle's crew changed all four tires. Scott Hansen is pitted at the far end of the pits, closest to corner number four. And Rob, I didn't see if he changed four tires or not. We'll try and check that out for you. But for sure, both Mike Eddy and Dick Trickle changed all four tires. They look to be in pretty good shape, getting a lot of work done under yellow. The green flag came out the last time the cars flashed down the start-finish line, the main straightaway. Right now, Bob Seneca, after this round of pit stops, finds himself in the lead. I do not believe that Seneca came in during that round of stops. Seneca, who has been languishing back in 15th position, had stopped under that brief yellow now about 40 laps ago, was almost caught out there. He is out of sync with the other race leaders. Remains to be seen whether or not that is a factor as this race wears on. The yellow flag was for Kent Stauffer, and Ralph Sheheen is standing by.
Well, as you mentioned, Larry, Kent Stauffer's Thunderbird is the best hope.
Trouble in corner number three, and I think Mike Eddy is involved. Sorry to interrupt you, Ralph, but a major problem right between corners three and four. Yes, Mike Eddy is involved. There is damage to the right side of the car. Mike was trying to move his way through slower traffic in a major turn of events here at Milwaukee.
Mike involved in a very similar looking incident last weekend at Calgary. Did some serious damage to the rear end of the race car and also to the right front suspension. He manhandled that car to a 13th place finish. He's a tough, tough guy. It looks like, Larry, though, that the damage this time may just be superficial to the right rear bodywork.
Mike Eddy, along with Dick Trickle, they had lost some track position. They had about 10 cars between themselves and race leader Bob Seneca, and they were trying to work their way through the field. We did not see it develop. We're checking all of our videotapes right now to see if any of the cameras have it. Here's our best shot. Let's look for Eddy, see what happened. Well, it already began. Looks like Mike may have just lost it.
It sure does. You can see the blue car number 69 of Dick Beinlich and also the number 5 of Jeff Neal. Neal skating through. Tom Harrington was also involved, looking at it from a different perspective.
Eddie's on the outside in the black and yellow number 88.
And he got bumped by Dick Beinlich. Obviously, Eddy with a much faster car. Beinlich a lap down. Mike just didn't allow enough room, and he did hit Jeff Neal.
Here's Harrington spinning in there. Oh, Ken Schrader just sneaking underneath, but two of the fastest cars in this race involved in that, Mike Eddy and Jeff Neal. We have not had an opportunity to see Neal's car, but he looked like capable of leading this race, and what an unfortunate circumstance for both of them.
Mike Eddy remains out on the racetrack.
Well, here we are in the pits. There is Jeff Neal. And Ralph, what's it look like? Terminal, can it be fixed?
Well, they're working on it, Larry. It looks pretty much cosmetic right now. The worst damage is just behind the left rear tire. The body panel's pushed all the way in there. It is snapped in half, actually. There's a big tear right through the panel. The car is duct taping it back up, and Jeff Neal's going to go back out in front of the pack so we can get back to the tail end of the line.
Jeff is pitted down near corner number one. There you see him, just a glimpse at the top of the screen. We're hearing that they may go green the next time around. Jeff Neal may have to drive a limping car if indeed that does happen. After 89 laps at Seneca, Benson, now Bruce Vanderlyn, the pit stops have allowed him to creep up into the top five. Scott Hansen is fourth. Dennis Vogel also pit stops again, allowing him to creep up there, although both of those guys, of course, have been able to stay in the lead lap. But the biggest story is going to be Hansen, or rather Neal, sorry. If indeed they go green the next time, Jeff may just have to make do with what he's got. He just sped past the start-finish line. Seemed like it was full zone.
Sometimes these pit stops, when the leaders elect to come in and you think they're out of sync, well, sometimes it comes back to them. And that was the case for Seneca and Benson, now running in second position. And a great run also for Kenny Adams in car number 86. You can see him. He's in third position right behind Johnny Benson. Blew an engine last week into Canada on the fourth lap, and he may take over Rookie of the Year points league.
Well, Ralph Sheheen was standing by with Kent Stauffer. He had a bird's eye view of what was going on with Jeff Neal. Ralph, give us an update on what went down there in the pits here in the last 5 minutes.
Well, it was real active in a hurry, Larry. First off, Jeff Neal's crew, Harold Farrer Jr., his crew chief, has told me they don't think they have any suspension damage. They're going to run it for a minute and see how it feels at high speed. Mike Eddy did not even come into the pits. Howard Thomas telling me the crew is going to let them go out there and try it at high speed as well and see how the number 88 Nationwide's entry handles.
Scott Hansen now battling with Bruce Vanderlaan, picks up the third position. Ted Musgrave comes right along behind. He'll run in fourth in car number 98. Bob Seneca leading this race, has not won in 9 years as Musgrave picks up the position moving past Vanderlaan.
Meaning hasn't won at Milwaukee. Yeah, Bob's That's been right. winning a lot. He won a week ago, right. but and incidentally, to update you on the situations involving Mike Eddy and Jeff Neal, Eddy is about 25th in line right now with a large number of slower moving cars, seemingly running okay. Jeff Neal never did catch up with the pack before they went green. He is at the very tail of the pack, and he too seemingly running at top speed.
Ted Musgrave pulling alongside the 86 machine, and he takes over the third position. Kenny Adams drops to fourth, and now Musgrave will try to catch the teammates, Seneca and Benson, running 1-2. Now we see Scott Hansen has moved into the third position in car number 53. Scott, interestingly, as you mentioned, Larry, pitted at the complete opposite end. And when we talked to him this morning, he knew it was a calculated risk. We're riding with him. And as I was talking to him this morning, he said, yeah, this puts the pressure on my crew. I'll get in first. They'll get to go to work on my car first. And if they do their job well, it'll put me out back at the head of the pack. And of all the cars that came in on that most recent caution, he got out first. Otherwise, it could have been him involved in that incident with Blain and Benetti.
Excellent point. Scott Hansen, third in the race right now. There he is, that white, silver, and red trim, number 53. Second in points to Bob Seneca by just 5 points. He's just 5 points back. He's won one time this year. He's currently ranked third in laps led. He's had one pole position. And Rob, I think you mentioned this earlier, the only driver to complete all 2,000 laps up to this point in the 1991 AC-Delco ASA season.
Well, when you talk with crew chief Howie Leto and some of the other guys on that operation, they are as cohesive a unit as you'll find in ASA. And you certainly know whenever you're racing 200 miles, 300 laps, 400 or 500 laps, that it takes a team effort. And this is from on top of Johnny Benson's car. And if we were a bird, this is what we might see, traveling at 140 miles an hour down the back straightaway into turn number three. And it appears that he is losing touch ever so slowly from leader Bob Seneca.
Well, we told you about Mike Eddy. You can see the damage there on the right-hand side in the rear. And Eddy is passing cars. Remains to be seen whether or not he is as fast as the race leaders. But he certainly is in there pitching, throwing those hard highways.
And right behind him in car number 52 is Ken Schrader, the Delco Voyager battery Chevrolet. And he'll now get a lesson online here at Milwaukee. Ken has not spent many laps here. If anybody's a quick study, it's him. Anybody can jump in any kind of race car and go racing. You understand that he raced somewhere last night, and he'll race again tonight.
Well, second place now has begun to be a war again. There is Scott Hansen, John Benson Jr., and Hansen has picked up a position.
Benson was in earlier, therefore his tires may not be as fresh as those on the car number 53 of Scott Hansen. And as he tries to keep pace with Scott, Musgrave is closing in as well.
Well, while this is going on, Bob Seneca continues to round the bases faster than anybody else. He's touching them all the way around and leading this race by about a football field. But look at Scott Hansen talking about football field. Remember, he comes from Green Bay Packerland. He lives in the shadows of the stadium, and he has turned up the wick.
Well, a lot of people find it surprising to know that it took until 1989 before a rookie ever won a race in ASA competition. It was Scott Hansen. It was with the Baker Motorsports team, and it was right here on the Milwaukee Mile.
There you see the interval between first and second. We are two laps away from the halfway point. Two laps from lap number 100. 100 laps down, meaning 100 miles to go. And the sneaker, Bob Seneca, I guess he pulled his sneaky move earlier this week than normal. That is the accepted nickname for Bob Seneca. And usually that move that puts him to the front takes place about 65 or 75% of the race. But today it happened about one-third in. It's time for the Skin Bracer Mid-Race Summary. The leader, of course, will be Bob Seneca. The average speed of today's race up till now is a modest 85 miles per hour because of a couple of serious caution flags. We've had six lead changes officially at the start-finish line among three drivers, several others around this one-mile oval. A total of six cautions for 32 laps, bringing that average speed down, and 12 cars right now are listed as out of the race or behind the pit wall. That is the Menin Skin Bracer Mid-Race Summary.
Now we've got a battle shaping up second and third position. Scott Hansen has been by himself, and Hansen still by himself. The battle is well back on the track. Third and fourth, Johnny Benson and Ted Musgrave. You can see them right at the top of your screen.
Benson's got a... No, it's not Benson. I thought that might have been Benson in there, but that is the number 57 of Dennis Robertson, the only Canadian driver headed into today's race. He had pulled out a little earlier. He pulled into the backstretch. They obviously made their repairs and they're back out, but other than that right pink number, it looked like Benson.
Not only have we had competitive races all season long, up until last weekend at Calgary, they've been relatively incident-free, but the pattern continues at Milwaukee. A surprising number of incidents involving a lot of laps under cautions, 32 miles under caution.
Well, Bob Senninger continues to lead. There he is, showing his rear back blue bumper to everybody else. Can he hold it? Well, we'll find out. There is, of course, a series of these ASA races live on the National Network in 1991. Our next stop will be at the High Banks of Odessa, Missouri. That's on the 28th of July for the Western Auto 300. On the 11th of August, we'll move into the Keystone State, Pennsylvania, for the Jennerstown, Pennsylvania 300. And in September, the St. Paul, Minnesota 300 on a facility not at all unlike this one. It's a state fairgrounds, but a track a little shorter than this.
Battle continues to rage between Johnny Benson and Ted Musgrave. While we were away, there was quite a bit of paint trading between these two chauffeurs.
You know, Benson is showing a lot of moxie today, Rob. He is the youngest driver in terms of miles of experience in ASA competition among all the guys who've been running up front today. Neil is young, but he doesn't have, he has more experience than what Benson does. But Benson has been driving this race like a veteran. He's been right there among them. And he's been in a position to strike all day long.
A whole host of these drivers that compete with ASA cut their racing teeth at Berlin Raceway in Marne, Michigan, near Grand Rapids. A lot of folks say if you can figure out how to make a car go fast there, you can get one dialed in anywhere. Benson had a lot of experience on that racetrack with very limited laps anywhere else up until 1990.
Berlin is a little bit bigger than a half mile. It's not a flat racetrack like Milwaukee, nor is it a high bank racetrack like Winchester or Salem. It's like right in the middle and has these long sweeping corners. And Rob, as you pointed out, it's a tough place to get around in consistently fast.
As Ted Musgrave continues to work on Benson in that battle for third position, the last ASA win for Ted came on the same racetrack where these drivers will compete next week. Of course, it won't be a televised race, but we'll be up in the Saginaw, Michigan area for what a lot of people refer to as ASA's only road course. It's about five turns. It's sort of an oval, but their elevation changes and almost a reverse camber turn one.
The only thing that makes it an oval is that all the corners are left-handers, and that's about it. Drivers who have won in 1991, Mike Eddy still is the only multiple race winner. Again, you're looking at third place up for grabs. Eddy has won three times. Single race winners have been Glenn Allen Jr., Scott Hansen, Darrell Waltrip, the last televised race at Nashville, and Bob Senninger, who continues to lead this race. But Hansen is running second, Senninger is first, and third place looks like that Ted Musgrave would like to capture from Johnny Benson. But as Benson has been all day long, he's difficult to get around.
Well, it's kind of interesting in that Musgrave's early ASA career pretty much paralleled Benson's. A number of races in Ted's rookie season, he had second place finishes to a guy named Butch Miller. A lot of people feel he's probably as good as has ever driven one of these late models on a half-mile racetrack. And Benson was several second place finishes to his credit as well. And you just got to get over that hump. He was hoping today might be
Musgrave.
Today.
Musgrave this time says, boy, it's time to go. He charges into corner number three, drives very hard, coming out of the fourth corner. Musgrave on the low side. Benson stands on the throttle. He's trying to hold on, but I don't think he has the line this time.
Ted's qualifying run was disappointing yesterday, and now we'll see what Benson is looking at. Musgrave's in trouble.
Ted Musgrave, you saw it live from John Benson's cockpit. Ted Musgrave was digging to hold his line on the inside. I don't think there was any touch between the two cars. It appeared as though Musgrave just spun out.
What a great shot. Now, Musgrave, you can see as the car turns around and heads the proper direction once again, there is no damage to that car. Maybe just a little bit of bent pride on the part of Musgrave. And as you said, I don't think there's any contact between those two machines.
Remarkable moment because you saw no jolt or bump with the in-car camera as the cars were going around that corner. And in point of fact, Musgrave had the line down on the bottom. Here's what it looks like, Rob.
Now, take a look again out the left side of Johnny Benson Chevrolet. They're close, Musgrave's in control. Now you can see the right rear corner coming toward car number 21, and there were a whole bunch of race cars behind him, and nobody fortunately collected. You can also see how close that inside retaining wall is down the back straightaway, and Ted did a great job of keeping the machine off the concrete.
So let's see what it looked like from the outside. Let's see if the outside shot agrees with the inside that there was no contact.
They're side by side, about a uniform 2 feet separating those two race cars. Benson giving him plenty of room on the bottom of the racetrack. Musgrave had the position, Larry. He had him passed.
Yep, and Ted Musgrave, just seeing it get away, pitcher threw that knuckleball, and it missed the plate by a mile, sailed over the catcher's head, and Musgrave goes spinning into the grass.
Let's take one more look at this incident down in turn number one, and you can see Musgrave's car sliding, the rear end getting just a bit out of shape. Benson's going, oh no, I'm sure at that very moment.
You guys in the truck saved the best one for last. That was the most telling of the three angles, although it was extremely well covered. And Ted Musgrave, he's going to need some new tires. The yellow flag appears to be one of those mid-race, fairly lengthy ones, giving everybody an opportunity to pit. I'm sure Mike Eddy is happy. He was involved in an incident. Remember, this is the first time Mike has had to check that car since that incident. Musgrave, they're going to be looking closely at those tires after that spin. And, of course, Jeff Neal also was looking forward to have some more inspection of his car damaged in the last yellow. Laps now in the books for the Blain's Farman Fleet 200 here on the Nashville Network Live. This is the American Speed Association, the AC Delco Challenge Series. Got a good look at the top five, and Bob Seneker has had easy sailing here for the last 10 or 15 green flag laps. Pit stop shuffling gave him a big lead over second and third place, but now they're right on his back bumper. However, let's go check in with Ralph Shaheen and get upgraded on the Ted Musgrave situation.
Ray Day is a crew chief for Ted. Ray, how is the car now?
Well, the car is handling pretty good, except on that last set of tires, we had a left rear tire going down, and we got awful loose.
So no problems due to the incident?
No, the car will be fine. As soon as we get some tires on that, we can depend on it.
Okay, that's the story from Ted Musgrave. We'll just have to keep an eye on him and see what he can do with the new tires.
All right, Ralph, let's keep an eye on race leader Bob Seneker. There's Scott Hansen filling his mirror as they rocket off of corner number four. That green flag flickers. And Mr. Seneker, the better that he is, I think is about to get the first challenge he's had in the last 15 minutes.
It's been a long time this afternoon since Scott Hansen has been in a position to make a move for the lead. He's running in second place, now right behind Seneker as the two of them separate themselves from the third running car number 21 of Johnny Benson, who's fighting through some hot traffic.
As we look at first and second, I want to make a call about two other drivers we haven't mentioned for a long time. Yep, they're still in it, and they're very competitive. The drivers I want to mention are Trickle and Tony Raines. We're going to take a look at the whole field. There the leaders go through. There is fourth place Trickle, and there is Tony Raines. Now here's the rest of the field. You see Mike Eddy going past. There's Jeff Neal still on the lead lap. Dennis Vogel in that bright red and yellow car. You can see how close the rest of the field is. We are timing the leader as he goes around. That leader is Bob Seneker. He seems to be running right fine, thank you. We kind of thought that Scott Hansen would really give him a challenge. Seneker is rumbling off of corner number four. He'll be crossing the start-finish line in 31.9 seconds. Pretty good lap for mid-race. Third place is side-by-side with 31.9, I think, is about the pace that everybody thought they would have to run to win.
Surprising in light of the fact that Seneker has not been in since lap 54. And Nick Trickle fighting his way back to the front in car number 99, now dueling once again with Johnny Benson in car number 21. And that's almost deja vu from the race that we saw just prior to the yellow, the battle between then Benson and Musgrave running for position. And look at Tony Raines right behind him. Tony is a young guy that a lot of people have compared, Larry, and what a compliment to a young Bob Seneker. He's aggressive when he needs to be, but he's patient when he must be most of the time.
Well, Tony has had his share of hard luck this year. He started this race in 21st position. He had to work his way through the non-qualifiers race. Here's John Benson. You can see him looking straight ahead. His peripheral vision is showing him Dick Trickle, showing him getting a little bit of advantage. Now Trickle comes back. Boy, they are wheel-to-wheel, hub-to-hub.
several battles like this one for Johnny Benson. The car works very well coming off the corners. He gets a good run. He's either got the right gearing or he's got very strong horsepower. Now he has to give way. And right behind Triple.
Look at Reigns. Look at Reigns. And Reigns wiggles going into corner number one. Loses valuable ground. Benson is able to keep the momentum and turns back Tony Reigns.
Look who else is right back up in there. Dennis Lantman right behind Reigns in car number one, nine.
Remarkable.
And right behind him is John Ziegler, who runs only a handful of ASA shows.
And Johnny Z is familiar with this racetrack. He is one of those Badger Bad guys who is here this week that we mentioned near the top of the show. He is trying to carry that blue flag of the state of Wisconsin proudly.
There are a lot of drivers that probably would run more if they could afford to run more. John Ziegler has kind of the opposite problem. His wife was telling me yesterday that John's business is so successful, it only allows him to run on a part-time basis.
Well, seeing these guys run this close is reminiscent of Saturday night racing. I think in the Nashville show, I said this was Saturday night racing gone big time to Sunday afternoon. That was actually quite a misnomer because that goes back to 1973 when this division moved into the big time. And since that time, they've built up quite a reputation. And as everybody knows, they are responsible for the careers of Alan Kowicki, Mark Martin. We throw in Mike Eddy into that group because he certainly has established quite a reputation for himself. Dick Trickle and Rusty Wallace.
Gentlemen, we've got a great battle going on for third place, but in second place is Scott Hansen, and Howie Leto is his crew chief. Howie, you've been running at a feverish pace all day. Is that where you want to be?
Well, we'd like to be leading, but right now running second isn't all bad. Car's not perfect, it's getting better. We made some adjustments at our pit stop, and right now the Delta Cross Chevy Lumina got behind the wheels running real good. So.
But is this a pace that you can keep up all day?
Well, we're watching the clock real close. We can make it on gas. We may pit for tires, then again, we'd be giving up a lot of track position, so it's gonna be a judgment call when the time comes.
It'll be interesting to see how this plays out, gentlemen. One thing we did want to mention as well about Scott Hansen, you might remember that first pit stop he made, and we questioned whether or not he took two tires and a full tank of gas. He took four tires and a full fuel load. This team down here, the Baker Motorsports entry team, did a fantastic job in that pit stop of getting him out as quick as they did. Also, we checked with Howard Thomas, Mike Eddy's crew chief, and he told me there was just bodywork damage to the 88. They checked the car out, he's fine, and he's moving through the field.
Excellent, Ralph. That was a very good point because Hansen's stop was absolutely superb. He left the pit area a good 10 seconds before everybody did. Bob Seneker comes into this race as the points leader, but just by 5 points. Now, we talked to him earlier this week about leading the points at this point in the season. Usually it doesn't happen for him until much later. Was he comfortable leading this early?
Well, Ralph, it's still a long season to go yet, so points aren't that important at this time to be in the lead. Just being near the front is what we need. This race is kind of tough for us. I have a hard time getting the car to go fast here. It's the top 10 runner, I know that, but to win is going to be really tough.
Well, he certainly looks like he's in a winning posture again today, and if he could win today, it would be two in a row, and maybe he can challenge that win streak of three that Mike Eddy had earlier this season, the best one of the year. Nobody else has won more than one.
We were concerned that this racetrack might not prove as racy as the Higher Bank Nashville Motor Raceway, and you were talking about Nashville a moment ago. We probably should extend an apology to Darrell Waltrip and his crew. I had said last weekend that was a four-year-old race car. We understand that the very last week before the Nashville race, they finished a brand new machine, and that is, in fact, what Darrell drove to victory. And frankly, Larry, I think that makes his win even more remarkable because he did it with no time on that car.
Jeff Hammond and Western Auto guys, if you guys are tuning in this broadcast, hats off to you for
absolutely
an extremely well-constructed race car. I saw that incident live, and when that car landed on its side, I thought, hey, that roll cage structure has its integrity, and as long as Darrell was able to stay inside, he was okay, and sure enough, that's the way it was. So congratulations, gentlemen, surviving Darrell surviving a very spectacular crash at 200 miles an hour. Well, riding with Scott Hansen, who is still continuing to chase Bob Seneker, we'll be back and see if he can catch him. Many laps to go, and there is that bright blue Wisconsin State flag we were referring to a few moments ago. Top five, Seneker, Hansen, Dick Trickle, now third, Johnny Benson Jr. fourth, and Tony Raines, a solid fifth position.
An excellent battle shaping up. Fourth, fifth, and sixth position. Johnny Benson barely ahead of Tony Raines and suddenly looming in both of their rearview mirrors is that Nationwide Pontiac of Mike Eddy. And if there was any doubt as to whether or not that car was still capable of running up in front, Mike has erased that in a hurry.
What a tremendous run for Mike Eddy. Look who he's already gotten around, Ted Musgrave. We saw how strong Musgrave was earlier. Now, he may have passed him in that Musgrave spin. Looks like Musgrave is running quick, but what a tremendous race for numbers 88 and 98.
Well, the cream rises to the top, and the toughest of the races, and this has been one of the toughest. Six lead changes among three drivers, seven caution periods, 24 cars of our 36-car starting field still remaining on the racetrack, and Eddy is making a pass of Raines.
There's Mike Eddy in the Nationwide Pontiac going to the inside. Mike Eddy in the colors of racetrack death for other racing people, the black stealth colors, moves to the inside of Raines. Raines is not ready to let go. Tony Raines continues to hold on the high side, but Eddy, as quickly as he's been running, once he's worked himself to the inside, he's going to be very difficult to hold back, and they are both moving in on Johnny Benson Jr.
They're doing that quickly, and Ted Musgrave appears to be faster than both of the machines in front of him. As look at him move right in on the back bumper of Mike Eddy's car number 88. And it has taken Eddy a lot longer than I thought it would to get around Raines as quickly as he caught him.
Boy, it looked like he had him, but Tony was right there in that second groove. And that second groove here at Milwaukee will work because this is a flat racetrack. And so if you have the horsepower, you don't lose quite that much on the outside.
Well, these engines are all what they call 9-to-1 engines. The compression ratio is limited to extend engine life. And what that means is that they have to keep the revs up, the RPMs up. And on the high side, you're able to do that better than you can on the bottom.
Incidentally, Musgrave is definitely running rich on two or three separate laps when he backs off going to number one. I've seen flames come out from underneath the car, the exhaust, when he gets out of the throttle. The way that guys, the drivers drive this track, they brush brake, and Mike Eddy once again looks like he's going to strong arm his way through. They brush brake going into the corners. It's not a hard brake at all. And they're back on the throttle full as quickly as they can to go around these long sweeping turns.
What they try to do is what they refer to as letting the car roll through the corner. You want to hit the brakes early and then get back off of it quickly.
Tom Harrington finds himself in no man's land. He was just caught in a bad position. He had no opportunity to get out of the way, and Tony Raines, unfortunately, Tony the Tiger, bit the big one on that one.
Tom Harrington, the former pro football player now hailing from Tennessee, was very much in the hunt. He was having his best ASA run in a long time before he was involved in that accident.
And Dennis Lampman in that orange and white number 9 continues to hang in there. Lampman, we talked about him in the actual starting grid of the race, having his best ASA season, and this is one of his best races on a mile.
Looking now over the back spoiler of the Valvoline Berger Chevrolet of Johnny Benson Jr., as he has a very modest distance separating himself from Mike Eddy. Eddie's not closing very quickly, and you can see now behind Eddy that Musgrave and Raines are battling for position. Continuing to ride with Johnny Benson now as he moves down into turn number one and past that main grandstand yet another time, and not a whole lot of race left for these drivers.
After five of the seven races of 1991, John Benson was the points leader. His 15th place finish last week in Calgary is what really put him back behind both Bob Seneca and Scott Hansen. He actually spun out on lap 400 trying to stay on the lead lap, but he really wasn't in that tremendously racy position last week at that point as he has been most of the races this year.
Battle for second between Scott Hansen and Dick Trickle. Trickle has caught Hansen, now closes in on him as Bob Seneca has moved well away from this battling pair.
Trickle's been an interesting story. He really hasn't contended for the lead outside of those first 25 or 30 laps. He's had no incidents that we've seen on the racetrack. He's not been involved in a spin like Eddie or a crash like Neil. He's just been there, but he hasn't battled for the lead. You have the feeling with all the laps he has on this track and all the experience in ASA type cars, this guy may be running exactly where he wants to be.
Bruce Vanderlaan in the car number 40 is slowed down on the back straightaway. Looks like he's going to be bringing the machine in behind the pit wall. And he's another one of these drivers that has had some very strong runs this season. On the first five races, at one point in the race, he was running in the top five. And the battle continues to rage for that second position between Hansen and Trickle.
Scott Hansen in the Delta Fawcett car turns the Fawcett to the right too much and gives Trickle a big opening. Now, this hasn't worked for other drivers in the past. Let's see if Trickle can parlay it to a position. Yeah, he's got it.
Trickle never shows a lot of excitement, but he was very much looking forward to this race. I live all the way down in South Florida. Turned in a talk show one day, and they were having a phone conversation with Trickle. He said he couldn't wait to get back to Milwaukee.
And that last shot as the drivers exited the high speed corner number two, you could see the interval between first, second, and third, and here is another shot of it.
Earlier in the race, Scott Hansen had the same perspective. The car kept drifting to the outside of the racetrack. When Ralph was talking to Howie Letow, he seemed to feel like things were in pretty good shape. He may need another set of tires before the race is over. While we're talking about tires, Larry, remember, leader Bob Seneca has not been in since lap 54.
Scott Hansen running in third position, and there is that race leader who may be running short on tires. Does he need another yellow flag? Remember what happened at Nashville. Seneca pitted late on, got fresh tires. He was fast, but still couldn't beat Darrell Waltrip, who did not pit and had old tires.
We've gone away from it for a while, but it hasn't subsided at all. This battle for position between Mike Eddy, Johnny Benson, and Ted Musgrave. Right behind them are Tony Raines and Dennis Lantman. Five automobiles dueling for that fourth, fifth, sixth, and eighth positions. And, you know, Benson has just had to fend off challenges all day long. He's got to be getting tired.
Johnny Benson almost into the light gray matter in corner number three. Now, he's done that a couple laps before, and it looked like he had given up the position, but somehow he was able to come back just like he does on this lap.
As he continues to battle with Mike Eddy, we talked about his efforts last weekend. He qualified second, jumped into the lead early at Calgary, ran away to a straightaway advantage, and then was involved, not of his own fault, in an accident on the racetrack, and he really wasn't competitive after that.
After 144 laps, or almost the three-quarter mark, as we continue to keep very close tabs on this fight for fourth position, you're riding with John Benson and looking at Mike Eddy. Again, that's third, make that fourth and fifth. From the top, Seneca leads, Dick Trickle is second, 53, Scott Hansen is third, Benson fourth, Eddy right there is fifth, Ted Musgrave is sixth, Tony Raines is seventh, Dennis Lampton is eighth, the 93 car of Johnny Z, John Ziegler, is ninth. And in 10th position is Jay Sauter, someone we have not talked about all day, but he's still held on into the top 10.
Two other cars on the lead lap. Bob Minner having a good run in car number 20, and also the local driver Dennis Vogel in car number 51. And Eddie's still trying to get by Benson, and Benson just won't let him do it. And now finally, Mike with a slight edge going down into the corner. Again, Benson pulls back on the high side. He has got a strong power plant in that car number 21.
It's like a wide receiver and a defensive back running down the field on a long fly pattern. Both of them are trying to outmaneuver the other one, and they can't shake the other.
Well, Eddie again with a slight advantage going into the turn. Now look at Benson fight back coming out of turn number four, and he'll try to use the lap car of Terry Baldry to his advantage. But he does, however, give Mike Eddy plenty of racing room. Musgrave has got to be getting frustrated behind him.
Teddy's been in that position many times today. It seems like he's crept up on people, moved up to pass somebody. He found him side by side, no place to race. There is definitely not a third groove in the corners at Milwaukee. The straightaways, yes, but not in the turns.
Now again, looking at the left side of Johnny Benson's race car, and again, you can see Mike Eddy's Pontiac slightly disappearing ahead, and again, Benson pulls him going down the chute. Just a difference in the way these two race cars are set up, and both appear to be running in their best grooves for the time being. And there's Musgrave. He's now elected to go down beneath Mike Eddy, and I'm not really sure that this racetrack is going to allow Musgrave to give either of the drivers in front of him the advantage of a slingshot or a draft.
Drafting here is just simply not a factor on this racetrack, and Musgrave has got to be getting a little frustrated. You can see him in the cockpit changing his mind continuously. Should I follow Eddy? Should I follow Benson? And just when one seems to have the advantage, the roles reverse. Musgrave has to change his mind.
I'll point out one thing about Mike Eddy's driving here this afternoon, and it's been typical of his style all season long. It's a different Mike Eddy we've seen this year. He has always had the reputation of being ASA's intimidator. When he comes up behind a lot of the drivers, they'll move out of the way, fearing that he'll move them out of the way with his own race car if he has to. But Mike this year has given plenty of room to everybody he's raced against.
What a warm moment in the middle of combat in a motor race. They went to lap Dean Smith, or Dean South, and as they moved to the high side, Johnny Benson gave Mike Eddy enough room. He said, hey, you've been racing me clean. I'm going to give you the room to pass this lap car. That was a very special moment.
Absolutely. And Benson's still able to hang on to that position with Musgrave there to challenge.
Well, as this has been going on, Bob Seneca has continued to set the pace. We now hear from the pits that there may be some conversation going on among the crew about the fuel situation with Bob Seneca. How about it, Ralph? Any insight?
Well, you're right, Larry. This is Dave Taylor, the crew chief for Bob Seneca. Now, Dave, you were one of the first cars to pit. Can you go all the way on fuel?
No, right now, the lean automotive for Chevrolet, we can run to about lap 175, and we desperately need a caution. We're going to bolt fresh rubber on when we do pit for fuel, because that's going to take us to the end.
So if we don't see a caution, then it's lap 175 or so. But if we see the next caution, is that when you're coming in?
The next caution, we're coming in definitely. And if we pit under green, it's going to be fuels and possibly two tires to try and make it up on the green.
If you get the fuel and the new tires, do you think that might be enough to make up the difference he might lose by pitting?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that everybody else has got to pit at least one more time. If we put two tires and fuel, we'll stay out on the following caution when they pit.
Well, I don't want to argue with Dave Taylor, but I'm not sure that they do all have to pit again.
Yeah, I agree with you. It seems like they've stopped soon enough. There is that race leader, Bob Seneca, left-hand side of your screen, watching the gauges, listening to every sound that engine makes, and looking for the yellow flag. Right now, Dennis Vogel from Manitowoc, Wisconsin, is the man who is the only hurdle between that man, race leader Bob Seneca, and second place Dick Trickle on the right-hand side of your screen. Trickle has snuck up, pulling an old Bob Seneca move. Quietly, he has moved toward the front, and Trickle is beginning to have designs on the lead position.
Well, although things have subsided between car number 21 and Benson, we got
the yellow flag. Bob Seneca's godsend.
Savior. Absolutely. Just what he wanted.
What a tremendous break for Bob Seneca. Now, we know he's going to lose some track position, but he has got to be crossing himself in the cockpit right now.
Well, and typically, I think, Larry, most of the lead lap automobiles will follow the leader's lead in terms of pit stops. And when Bob Seneca comes on pit road at this juncture with still 45 miles to go, I'd be surprised if all of the front lap automobiles didn't come in for tires.
Yeah, they have nothing to lose, really. They want to come in and have the cars prepared in the best possible way for this run to the checkered. We are a little more than 40 laps away from the checkered flag, and this could set up a very interesting finish.
Here's going to be the race. You know, we talked throughout the race about the pit positions. Mike Eddy and Bob Seneca at the head of the file. They'll have to come on pit road very slowly. Now we're at Bob Seneca's pit. Because he's the defending national champion, he always gets his choice of pit stall. He picks the one at the turn one into pit road. Scott Hansen completely at the other end. He'll be in first. It's up to the crew.
And Dick Trickle running second spot right in the center of the pits. He picked that stall because it is the single largest one all the way up and down pit road. Now, quickly, we'll give you a rundown here as much as we can. In 11th position was Bob Menner before the yellow. Dennis Vogel was 12th. Kent Stauffer back out on the track. One lap down is 13th. Jeff Neal had lost a lap. He was 14th. The 86 car was running in the number 15 position. That, of course, is Kenny Adams. Ken Schrader had lost two laps. He was 16th. We'll get off of that. Here come the leaders. This will be the race that Rob talked about. You can see them fanning out. Scott Hansen comes to a stop. Seneca goes all the way to the head of the line where Ralph Shaheen is standing by. Seneca roars in, slams on the brake, slides to a stop.
Larry, he almost took out one of his crew people. In fact, it looks like it was Dave Taylor that was going around to the right side. Seneca actually slid over the yellow and white line, almost taking him out. They put right side tires on. Now the left side tires going on the Lane Automotive Chevrolet. The fuel is in the car. The lefts come off. The sticker tires are getting onto the car. And Bob Seneca is going to be going back out in just a minute. Tony Raines is out. Take a look back at Mike Eddy. He's doing the same. Bob Seneca is out and ready to go to the checker.
Oh, this is going to be interesting. I think Tony Raines is leading this race right now, Rob. We'll find out. A lot of the lap cars chose not to pit that time, but I think Raines got out first.
And right behind him came Jay Sauter. He'll come into the screen momentarily. I'm not sure. I believe those two cars only took on two tires. A calculated risk on their part. We had been watching Scott Hansen, Bob Seneca, and Mike Eddy. We didn't even take a look at these two guys.
Well, Dave Stomp's car is unfortunately disabled right on pit road. He's at the start-finish line as it extends through the pit area. The wrecker is just coming to pick him up now. We're still two or three more laps under yellow, so we'll take this break. Now, the history of stock car racing on this Milwaukee Mile began in 1956. These were known as new cars then. They actually began racing here in 1912, but this track did not show up on national schedules until 1939. Now, these shots are from the early 1960s, and that red, white, and blue car up front is Parnelli Jones, who had the greatest streak in the history of Milwaukee. He once, in a three-year period, won seven stock car races in a row. Can you believe that? The first stock car race was ever held here in 1956, and Troy Ruttman, who had won the Indianapolis 500 4 years earlier, that's A.J. Foyt, incidentally, won that race.
And these were back when stock cars were truly production-based automobiles, and Parnelli's Mercury, just like the ones my dad used to sell out of his dealership.
There is Parnelli. This was the annual biggest race here at Milwaukee, the Governor's Cup on the USAC stock car circuit, and USAC stock cars dominated the racing here in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, and then in the 80s, the torch was passed to ASA, and the result is what you are watching today, and there is Tony Raines.
Well, the body styles may have changed in the last 25 or 30 years, but the competitiveness of the men behind the wheels is just as tough as it always was.
Some of the drivers who won here, Paul Goldsmith, Fred Lorenzen, we mentioned Parnelli, A.J. Foyt, Bobby Unser, Bobby Allison, Al Unser, Roger McCluskey, and Rob, I also found a very interesting rundown from the race 10 years ago this weekend, and we're looking at the top five today. 10 years ago, Rusty Wallace won this race, Joe Ruttman was second, Bobby Allison third, Alan Kowicki, Tom Jones, and Schrader were also in that race.
Some of the same names, but a whole lot of new ones in 1991. The green is out, Tony Raines is the leader, and he'll have to deal with lap traffic as they come down for the green.
By the way, just to put this in perspective, that race in 1956, the first stock car race ever, was 35 years short of one single day. It was held on July 15th. Right now, the action is 1991, and it's up front, and there it is. Tony Raines, Scott Hansen, cars number 25 and 53.
I don't know whether or not our viewers saw that restart for Scott Hansen, but it was incredible. He didn't have a particularly good pit stop, but on the restart, dropped way to the bottom of the racetrack, went from fourth or fifth position to second, just like that, just in a heartbeat. And now Tony Raines is really going to have to work hard to keep Hansen behind him.
And he has got 37 laps to do it. 163 miles are complete, 37 miles to go. Raines is trying to decide, do I lap Harris on the outside or the inside? I think he's going to opt for that upper lane, the middle of the racetrack.
Danny Adams will try to stay out of trouble and try to give these leaders racing room. I wouldn't want to be in that car right now.
Kenny is doing what he can, and look at Hansen. Hansen's making it three wide, coming out of corner number four. Raines is standing on the throttle. He's trying to try and hold on, going into corner number one. He drops down low. Does he have enough room? He closes the door. Here comes Seneca.
Seneca also used the high side of the racetrack to make the pass of Kenny Adams in car number 86 and almost got by Scott Hansen in the process.
Bob Seneca also making a cannon's charge to the front after that pit stop. Raines trying to hold on. He sees veterans side by side in the rearview mirror.
Wiggle for Scott Hansen in turn number three. Seneca tries to take advantage. No, says Scott as they come off four.
Scott Hansen helps out leader Tony Raines. Here comes Dick Trickle in that all-white car running in fourth position. Here comes number 99.
Behind Trickle, it's car number 21, Johnny Benson, but he's got some time to make up on the racetrack. And now Tony Raines momentarily with some breathing room as Seneca and Hansen battle for second.
We set this up as a battle between the Badger Battalion, about 12 cars from the state of Wisconsin showing up, and the Michigan Monsters, but I don't think anybody really counted on one of those Indiana interlopers, Tony Raines, leading this late in the race.
Well, Tony made a move this spring to Pennsylvania where he could be close to the operation of his car owner, Ernie Roselli. And he was very reluctant to tell us that, I guess I better say my new hometown is Bigler, Pennsylvania.
Keystone man now. Incidentally, Mike, Eddie has also got a shot. You don't see Eddie in this shot, he's in the end car. But Eddie has moved up to fifth position, but the battle continues up front. 166 laps down now.
Hansen on the low side, Seneca forced up high.
Dick Trickle has slowed. Oh, what a disappointment for the Badger Homestaters. Dick Trickle is losing his chance to win this race. the one that he wanted oh so much.
Dick, Trickle the Trickle Motorsport Chevrolet. It used to be a Camaro. It's 4 years old. It was badly damaged at Montreal in a qualifying incident 3 years ago, but appeared to be a car to be here today, and Trickle's afternoon may be over. At least chances for victory, and what you'd never want to see, the hood pins are coming out of car number 99.
Dick Trickle has won 1,200 races in his long and storied career. He used to run 7 and 8 nights a week, or 7 or 8 times a week, and win 5 or 6 of them, but he will not win today on the Milwaukee Mile.
Well, it was a rather strange-looking slowing on the racetrack.
Johnny Benson is coming in, another one of the race leaders. You're riding with John Benson. He coasts to a stop. It almost looked like it was silent. A lot of noise here at horse up in the announce booth, but Benson doesn't stop. What a strange moment. Oh, he's making that hard left-hander.
Oh, what a disappointment for Johnny Benson and Dick Trickle. It looks like both of their afternoons concluding almost simultaneously. And back to Trickle. The way he slowed down on the racetrack, it looked very similar to what we saw from Bob Seneca at Cayuga a couple of weeks ago. Lost an oil sump belt off the engine. They may get him back in the race.
The stealth fighter is moving up. That black car is showing up. Mike Eddy has crept into this picture, showing you the front three cars. Reigns, Seneca, Hansen, and just behind them is that black and gold number 88.
Well, lest any of our race fans thought this young upstart from northern Indiana was a fluke at Nashville, he's proving that he's got the mettle of the best of them this afternoon. Tony Raines just continuing to run a perfect line and holding the guy that many people compare him to, Bob Seneca, and Scott Hansen at bay. And look at the black car number 88. Yeah.
Well, if Raines wanted to be challenged, he's definitely getting that.
I reckon so.
Tony's going to find out exactly what he has in those 10 fingers underneath the racing gloves, because, boy, does he have his hands. Oh, look at the action. Artist at work. A symphony at nearly 150 miles an hour.
It's so unfortunate that race fans at home watching television don't have the opportunity to sit right down in the front couple of rows, because it's almost in slow motion when you watch it on television. Behind the wheel, it is totally different. And there goes Seneca.
Making his move. Bob Seneca creeps to the inside. He brings the white fender number 84 to the inside of Tony Raines. It looks like Seneca has the advantage. Raines stands on the throttle as hard as he possibly can in the corner. They're almost dead even as they go across the finish line, and Bob Seneca moves past, as does Mike Eddy.
Mike Eddy into third position. Scott Hansen doesn't like it. Tries to re-challenge on the bottom side. Says Mike. It's Seneca, Raines, Eddy now in third position. Hansen has dropped to fourth. You can see out the back side of car number 53, Ted Musgrave has moved to the fifth.
Well, we're going to take a chance here and try and leave this action for just a second, because standing by right now with a very important interview with Ralph Shaheen.
Trickle, you went out earlier than you wanted to. What was it that went wrong?
We ended up losing the belt on the drive, and lost the drive belt, pulleys and stuff, and ended up tightening the motor down. But we were a little bit loose to start with, and we got a little bit tight in the middle. Right there at the end of the last stop, they got it just right. I think we had something for them there, but it was a good race. It would have been a good, keen race. I'm sure I couldn't finish it because I wanted to be up front right now.
We showed you the action up front while Dick Trickle was talking. What had happened was, as you see, Mike Eddy has crept up to the inside of Tony Raines. It looks like Tony's reign in the first two positions is not long for this world. Hansen is trying to mimic what Mike Eddy did. There is race leader Bob Seneca. There is second place now Mike Eddy, and soon to be third Scott Hansen, and Tony Raines just that quickly from the lead goes to fourth.
Well, you can see now Tony Raines hanging on, or attempting to hang on, but Scott Hansen is going to dispatch him pretty quickly. And Mike Eddy had better hustle in car number 88. Bob Seneca appears to have a very, very strong race car.
1.58 seconds, the difference between Bob Seneca and Mike Eddy with 25 laps to go. 1.58 seconds, that was the handheld stopwatch, so you can challenge that, but that's pretty close.
Hansen is able to hang right with Eddy.
Yeah, and let's see if this duo can move in on Bob Seneca. That is really the big question with now about 24 and 28 laps. Seneca opened up by about 2/10 of a second, at least on that lap.
Well, as we mentioned, Bob's first win this season, coming a week ago at Calgary in Canada. And look at Scott Hansen. He's really putting the heat on Mike Eddy's car number 88. And now Hansen will try the high side of Eddy.
Oh, he's racing him. Very, very slippery on top, with the guy underneath you running just about as fast as you are. Almost impossible to pass up there.
Mike Eddy has worked very, very hard after that last caution just to get into the second position. And he just may have used up the race car in his quest to get back to the front. Average speed, about 91 miles an hour for the race with all the cautions that we've had. We're getting the report from Terry. Johnny Benson out with an engine. I think Ralph has him standing by.
Well, Johnny, you went out. You're right up there in the thick of things. What was it put your car out?
Well, I'll tell you what. The Valvoline Berger Chevrolet Lumina was really fast today. I'm not sure. I guess the front of the motor bolt come out of the drive thing, and she went.
You've had an opportunity to run with these guys. Who looks the strongest from inside the cockpit out of our leaders?
Well, I hope teammate Bobby Sedeker is going to win this, but Eddie Strong, there's about four or five guys really strong up there.
Only time will tell, gentlemen.
All right, Ralph. Bob Sedeker has won 67 times in his ASA career. He is the all-time leading winner and looking to add to that total again today. Mike Eddy with three wins in 1991. Has 31 career wins, and Scott Hansen is the relatively newcomer. He has four career wins, including one in 1991. So that gives you the rundown of their ASA career. But frankly speaking, in 1991, you got to say that these three guys are all in the same plane. Yeah, Eddie's had those three wins, but any given day, any given hour, any one of them can just smash the rest of the field to smithereens.
Well, and as we spoke with the disappointed Johnny Benson, including him and that quartet, those are the front four in the point standings. Sedeker now on the top of the heat. Mike Eddy, after a horrendous start to 1991, has clawed his way into fourth in the national standings. And look at that machine going literally sideways down in turn number one. He could taste the win here this afternoon.
Yeah, that's an indication that the driver is on the throttle and that the tires are old, and that still can be a factor. Because remember, we have 20 laps to go, but we're not on a half-mile racetrack. That means we've got 20 miles to go, reasonably long way in a motor race. Here's the interval between first and second.
It was 2.1 the last lap, and it has grown significantly.
Sedeker has progressively lengthened his margin the last four laps.
Mike Eddy doing what he can, but you can watch those two automobiles coming out of the corner. You previously saw from Hansen's car the wiggle by Eddy. Bob Sedeker's car just cornering as if literally on railroad tracks.
Bob Sedeker, who in 1990, 1 year ago, we'll check that interval one more time, was the leading winner. He won six times, won here today. We just about put him on that same pace, and the lead stretches one more time. So the rubber band is not helping Mike Eddy, but certainly working to Bob Sedeker's advantage.
Race is a long way from over. A caution flag could bunch things up dramatically, and a good restart by Scott Hansen could give him a shot at the lead, and Hansen does want that second position.
Scott Hansen in the number 53 car, that's the car out of Wisconsin right here, a car that they came in with a lot of hope for. They really hoped that they could do well at their home racetrack. They picked up the Delta Faucet sponsorship for today's race to go along with the Baker Enterprises of Wisconsin. And he has been in it all day long, but has found himself often in this position, following somebody else who's just scratching his claw and trying to get by.
A lap and a half ago, he was right there sitting on the back bumper, challenging for that second position. Now he's fallen back about two or three car lengths from Mike Eddy.
What it looks like is that Hansen is faster than Mike, but he's out of tires. And unless he gets a good run and Mike makes the slightest little mistake, allowing Scott to get by, he doesn't have the tires to pass him on the high side.
Sedeker with unquestionably the most comfortable lead that any driver has enjoyed in all of 1991. I've been to all of them, and they've all been close. 2.5 seconds is not a lot of time to make up on the racetrack, but that's the biggest lead anybody has seen this late in the race this year.
Bob Sedeker is absolutely amazing. The ASA crowd has seen him do this for over 20 years, and there were times in Bob's career. As we look at the first three, where he was absolutely maddening for the rest of the crowd. I've seen him go down two laps at Winchester in a 400-lap race, come back and win that race. I think that's where he picked up that nickname, Sneaker, because people would count him out, and all of a sudden we'd come down to the lap 30, the last 30 or 40 laps of the race, and there's Seneca at the front.
Well, and at the front he is right now, ahead of Mike Eddy and Scott Hansen, dueling for that second and third positions on the racetrack. Hansen just not able to make the pass. So creep up, challenge, and then fall back.
Bob Seneca is ranked twice in second rank that in laps led in 1991. Mike Eddy is the lap leader so far coming into this race at Milwaukee. Hansen was ranked third. So the three leading drivers of 1991 are up front in this race. It's appropriate that the ones who have led the most laps are 1, 2, 3 in the final stages here at Milwaukee.
He's out of the picture right now. Those of you wondering what has happened to Tony Raines, he's still running in the fourth position, but a number of car lengths back, and right behind him in fifth is currently Ted Musgrave. And you know, it may be time to get another interval real soon, because I'm not sure that Seneca's lead is being maintained. It almost appeared the last time by as if it was shrinking. There's Raines. He's running in fourth position, and not too far behind him is Ted Musgrave.
Tony did an excellent job after that last yellow with about 40 laps to go. He drove his heart out, and he held the leaders back behind him for about 10 laps, but it did look like he was out horsepowered this time around because everybody had fresh tires.
Yes, it did. Again, a brand new racing team for Tony Raines, the folks from Pennsylvania coming to the Midwest to contend with the best of the ASA. And look at that gap between first and second. It's gone.
And Eddie senses it. You can see Mike Eddy drop that car down on the bottom. He put the tires into the grass. He sees Bob Seneca coming back to him. Rob has run down the first five for you. Here are the next five. Jay Sauter is running in sixth. Dennis Lampman, terrific race in seventh position. Johnny Ziegler is in eighth position. We'll look at that interval again. As you can see, visually, it has shrunk. Ninth is John Menner.
1 second, Larry.
Down to 1 second. The Menner is in ninth position. And tenth is the Ford. Yes, Kent Stauffer is back out at it. The Thunderbird is flying again. Somehow, he has worked himself back into the top 10. One lap down. Neil is one lap down in 11th. And Dennis Vogel also one lap down in 12th. Again, recapping, because we only have about 10 laps to go. This could be a fight to the finish. The first five, Seneca, Eddy, Hansen, fourth and fifth on the screen, Musgrave and Raines.
Well, Ted pulling quickly away from Tony Raines, having appropriated fourth position, but he's well back of the top running three. 10 laps, 10 miles remaining in the Blaine Sparman Fleet 200 this afternoon. Well, just when we had counted out everybody but Bob Seneca, suddenly getting to 9, the referee stops the count, and Mike Eddy springs to his feet.
Absolutely. And Seneca may be watching. That was a good lap for him. Could have been lap traffic, but it was a good lap. He at least, I think, maintained that interval.
Again, this time by the start-finish line. The margin for the moment appears to be stable, right around 1 second.
Right, about the same. He had a good lap, as we mentioned. 191 laps down, 9 laps to go. Now, the responsibility of both of these drivers, Eddy and Seneca, each, is to try and be as perfect as they possibly can. Eddy, with that interval and only 9 miles to go, doesn't figure to catch Seneca unless he makes a mistake. So the worst thing that could happen for Mike is to overdrive the car, make a mistake, fall back 2 seconds, and absolutely his chances are over. So both of them are trying to drive perfect. With about 3 laps to go, if Mike has not caught Bob by then he'll start taking chances.
Absolutely. And if Mike is waiting for Seneca to make a mistake, it ain't going to happen.
You know that slogan about that particularly low place freezing over, it could be that long.
Well, and now you can see just barely able to get the two machines in a single frame as Seneca once again appears to be stretching it ever so slightly. Now, I wouldn't accuse Bob of toying with his rival, but I also wouldn't put him past
the minute. The nickname is Sneaker?
That's right.
Kind of fits into that category,
right.
Does it not?
Look right in front of Bob Seneca. He will have some lap traffic to contend with before this race is over.
You know, Rob, I think you just made an excellent point. I do now believe, as I reflect over the past 3 laps, that Seneca is basically attempting to control the intervals. He is a very crafty driver. It was set up by Ralph at the top of the show. And based on what we've seen now in the last lap and a half, it looks to me like he may be in control.
The guy that deserves some credit here this weekend is the crew chief of that team, a youngster named Dave Taylor. Came under a lot of fire because Seneca got 6 races into this season without a victory. Remember, he won 6 times in 1990. a swap of crew chiefs over the winter saw Taylor suddenly with a chance of a lifetime, but also the pressure of a lifetime, having to come in behind Chip Caputo, a veteran crew chief. Boy, you sure have to hand him some plaudits this afternoon.
Look at Seneca. Seneca has not put time so much between himself and Mike Eddy, but track distance. And that's an indication that he's driving the exact speed that he wants to be.
Five laps to go. Mike Eddy runs second. He now has as much gap between himself and Scott Hansen, who runs third, as separates him from leader Bob Seneca.
We just talked to Dave Taylor, crew chief for Bob Seneca, gentlemen, and he told me they have eased back just to save tires in case there's a late race caution and they need to run away from Mike Eddy. They mentioned Mike Eddy is a hard charger. They wanted a backup safety caution.
Thank you, Ralph. You make me sound like an expert. Thanks a lot, buddy.
You mean he has to make you sound like
one? All right. Hey, you're the one who locked the keys in the rental car.
I knew that was going to come back for the end of the race.
In the middle of the race, had to find them. I mean, here's a man hard at work.
Bob Seneca holds the lead to the checkered flag. He will have paced this race for 104 of the 200 laps.
Again, the previous winners in 1991. Come to leader, Ralph Seneca. Seneca has one win, Darrell Waltrip won, Scott Hansen won, Glenn Allen Jr. won, and Mike Eddy, black, yellow trim, Nationwide, Pontiac right there, has three wins, but Bob Seneca certainly looks like he is taking the modified Bluebird, the blue and white bird, if you will, to victory for the second time this season.
Back in Bob's early days of ASA, he was the dominant force. That's why he's won twice as many races as his next nearest challenger. His first victory in the Milwaukee Mile, the first race ever held here by ASA in 1978, driving a 1977 Chevrolet.
198 laps down, two to go. Seneca will be looking, hoping, praying for that white flag next time around. Yeah, he's controlling this, but Eddy is certainly within striking distance. And unlike a football game where the difference is 20 points or a baseball game where the difference is 15 runs, motor racing can change completely in a heartbeat.
Well, we saw that earlier this season at Cayuga when both Bob Seneca and Glenn Allen Jr. apparently way out in front had both of their automobiles fail in the closing laps of that race. White flag for Bob Seneca. Just three turns to go to the checkers.
Seneca has to maneuver around Jeff Neal. Eddy gets closer, but Seneca still in control. Moves smoothly to the high side of the Zurich Dewey. Down the back straightaway, 130, 140 miles an hour, brush braking around corner three and four.
Looks like it's going to be Bob Seneca's race this afternoon. He hasn't won on the Milwaukee Mile since 1982. He won in 78, 81, 82, and now in 1991. Bob Seneca winning the Blain's Farm and Fleet 200. A jubilant crew will celebrate.
Seneca becomes the second double winner of 1991, and Mike Eddy, who is trying to protect his league-leading three victories, has to settle for second position. It was a race that was fraught with yellow flags in the first half. For a while, it looked like it was going to be a brutal one. We had a couple of serious-looking crashes, no injuries, and Bob Seneca comes home the victor here at the Milwaukee Mile. Drivers starting today's race with career wins at the Milwaukee Mile included Harold Fair, Scott Hansen, Mike Eddy, Dick Trickle, and the man right now in victory lane, Bob Seneca, who won for the fourth time. I bet you can guess where Ralph Shaheen is.
That's right, brother. Here we are with Bob Seneca getting a cool drink of water. Bob will turn you around so everybody back home can see you. A great race again here at the AC Delco Challenge Series. Congratulations.
Thank you. The crew did a heck of a job. The second set of tires was perfect on our Bayshore Chevy. And third set, yeah, Kevin, he did a heck of a job. Pit stops were excellent. That last pit stop, we beat him out and had the right set of tires on and went for the win. It was terrific.
They didn't give you an easy day at all out there on the racetrack. You really had to fight your way through for this one.
Oh, I did. The first part of the race, I didn't know if I could keep up. In fact, they were pulling away when we got that second set of tires. Of course, we got the lead easily, and I just ran away for a while. But that end pit stop when we had a charge from third spot back was a heck of a race. It was really fun.
Well, there's one other gentleman that wants to say something to you. Gil Cashin from AC Delco. How about it?
Bob, a heck of a run here today. We promised the fans an exciting race, and you and Dick Trickle and Mike Eddy really put it on. You added a lot of points to that AC Delco Challenge. We're proud of you, and thanks for keeping the fans' interest here today.
Well, I'm glad they're happy, and we're happy too.
Great.
Thanks, Ralph.
There he is, gentlemen, your 1991 point leader, and a victory to add to that. Bob Seneca.
Recapping again the top 10, Seneca, Mike Eddy, Scott Hansen, and Ted Musgrave, and Tony Raines. There you see the first five. Sixth through 10th were Jim, make that Jay Sauter, Jim's his dad, Dennis Lampman, Bob Menner, John Ziegler, and Ken Stauffer. We'll be back with more. Again, the rundown unofficial, the top five, Bob Seneca, Mike Eddy, Scott Hansen, Ted Musgrave, and Tony Raines. One of the finest races in his young career, certainly a name to keep in mind. You have been watching live ASA Racing from the Milwaukee Mile, a Group 5 sports production. Our executive producer is Kathy McKee, a producer Ken Dennis, director Gary Clem, and our technical manager is Joel McKee. My thanks to the American Speed Association and the folks here at the Milwaukee Mile for their help in the production of this broadcast. We'll be back in a couple of weeks with more live ASA racing action on the Nashville Network. This was the second of five planned telecasts in the 1991 season, and if the first two races are any indication, this is going to be an exciting year in the AC-Delco Challenge featuring the stars and cars of the American Speed Association. My thanks to Rob Albright and Ralph Shaheen for their help in this broadcast. And until the next time, perhaps it'll be at the High Banks of Odessa. We'll see you at the races.